There are few bigger dates on the HBCU calendar than homecoming. Today in Greensboro, North Carolina A&T celebrates its heritage as alumni gather to rekindle friendships and share treasured memories. The centerpiece of the weekend is the game between the Aggies and Norfolk State. North Carolina A&T has their sights set on the postseason and need to keep the momentum going. But the Spartans' tough defense will test them today. It's MEAC College Football next. You're watching ESPN College Football presented by McDonald's, coming to you live from what Aggie fans call the greatest homecoming on earth. To grab a line from Outkast, the scene has been thick around campus and all around the town of Greensboro as it's painted blue and gold. North Carolina A&T hosts the Spartans of Norfolk State. Now, the Aggies are currently ranked 17th in the FCS Top 25. They're second in the MEAC behind FAMU, but of course, postseason implications. They're trying to make sure they keep it rolling so they can have some extra weekends. As we say hello and welcome in with the former Howard University and NFL quarterback Jay Walker, I'm Tiffany Green. Certainly, we've started to feel some of the electricity around campus, but what North Carolina A&T cannot do this week is be shocked again.
Yeah, they have to focus, and this has not been home sweet home for the Aggies. Their two losses on the season have come right here in Aggie Stadium, so they have to get rid of all the distractions. GHOE is special, we know that, but at the end of the game, like my coach used to say, the party don't start until we win the homecoming game, and that's what they must do. They must stay focused.
We'll see two great defenses, especially for the Aggies, and they are led by the MEAC sack leader in Daryl Johnson.
And Daryl Johnson is a guy that can really create havoc on the opposing offensive line. He's got fantastic speed, 6 feet, 5 inches, but he runs like a deer. He gets it done. And down here at North Carolina A&T, they've won championships based off their defense. He's a call to that championship-quality defense for the Aggies.
Now, the Spartans' offense has been anemic over the last few weeks. Aaron Savage can be a guy to make a turnaround.
And when your offense is struggling and a team that really is geared against giving the quarterback trouble, you need a running game. And Aaron Savage has the talent to be a special difference playmaker in this football game. He's going to really need to show up to take some of the pressure off the quarterback position for the Spartans.
All right, the series history between these two and North Carolina A&T leading it convincingly 30-9 last time in Greensboro. It was the Aggies shutting out the Spartans 35-0. They're hoping for a similar outcome here today. And there's certainly been a lot of Aggie pride all throughout the week for the homecoming festivities, as it was echoed in the stadium just a few seconds ago.
You'll hear a lot of Aggie pride throughout this game, and when they're saying Aggie pride, that means things are normally going well for the hometown team.
Malik Wilson bobbled the ball, picks it up, still on his feet, brought down just around the 17-yard line, and a penalty flag is quickly on the field. Well, the Aggies coming in at 6-2 on the season.
Can we call it a disappointing 6-2?
So that'll back the Aggies up just a little bit. Penalty called against them, and our good look here at Lamar Raynard, the fifth-year senior for the Aggies, 31-2 as a starter out of High Point, North Carolina.
Those are the intangibles, 6'4", 195 pounds. But that record there, 31-2, is phenomenal. But he has to be disappointed. Those two losses came in his senior year in games in which they were upset here at home. Versus a winless Morgan State squad at the time and versus Florida A&M.
I think that it came as a surprise to many, but since that time, as we talked with Coach Sam Washington, he said the last 2 weeks of practice have been great, and if they could play like they practiced, they could get off to a good start. The handoff to Markell Cartwright. Cartwright a teammate, former high school teammate of Raynard. And as we take a look at some of the impact players that we're expecting to see, Cartwright is one of them.
Yeah, Cartwright's definitely one of them. He can run the ball, trying to get to 1,000 yards on the season. And Elijah Bell is finally 100% healthy. He's a guy that's a difference maker at the wide receiver position. JT Wahi, he's going to have that assignment of going against Elijah Bell.
And Nigel Chavis, the best defensive player for the Spartans, according to their head coach, Latrell Scott. So second and 7 for the Aggies. Zachary Leslie in motion. And Raynard with another handoff to Cartwright, and Cartwright bursts up the middle. That's good for first down, brought down by Tyree Givers-Wilson.
Yeah, Cartwright's a guy that's got a lot of talent, particularly keeping his pad level low, finding holes in the defense. This is a guy that sat on the bench and shared a little bit of time, but really sat patiently behind Tariq Cohen. And ever since he's become the starter, they've not dropped off that much, which is saying something about Cartwright's talent.
He went off for 100-plus against the Spartans in his last meeting with Norfolk State. That was good for 13 yards. Raynard drops back, has time, airs it out. Nobody covering Malik Wilson on the outside, and just a missed opportunity there as there was nowhere within 5 feet of him.
Yeah, wide open there. Blown coverage by Norfolk State, allowing the second man through to go uncovered. Sometimes as a quarterback, those are the toughest throws to make when the wide receiver is wide open.
Sam Washington getting his first season as head coach here with the Aggies. Previously was the defensive coordinator, a vaunted defense throughout the nation, among the tops in the FCS. Raynard once again going to the outside, finds Leslie. And Leslie is brought down by Deshaun Dixon.
And Leslie's been probably the best wide receiver for the Aggies this season. He's really stepped up and emerged. Elijah Bell's a difference maker, but he's been hurt most of the season. Zachary Leslie's really stepped up and taken over the lead wide receiver role in this offense.
Leslie, the redshirt sophomore who has emerged, now 3rd and 5. Cartwright running out the backfield. Raynard stands in the pocket. Tough throw. Elijah Bell couldn't hang on to it. Broken up by JT Wahi.
And that's that matchup, and that's something you have to be concerned about. When this Aggie offense struggles, their third down percentage rate goes down tremendously. Come out here, they throw the ball third down. Incomplete pass. Good job by the visiting Spartans defense on the opening drive.
36% in third down efficiency for the Aggies as they are forced to punt here. On their first possession, back to receive for the Spartans is Marcus Taylor. Taylor with plenty of room to return. Gets a hold, and he's still on his feet across the 50-yard line. No one's near to touch him.
Job.
Could he run it back? Yes, sir! 69-yard punt return for a touchdown for the senior Marcus Taylor. He is a dangerous return man, and he showed you why.
Great job. Taylor sets it up nicely, but I want you to take a look at the job by Justin Toler coming up, number 49. Does a good job not to do the block in the back right there. Gets in front of him, gives the kicker a nudge. That's the final block that sprung Marcus Taylor. Marcus Taylor is a phenomenal special talent, making an impact on this game early.
We talked to the open just about how the offense has had a tough go of it as of late. One way to turn things around is special teams. And Josh Nardone did not make the extra point. So 6-0 Norfolk State. But how about the Spartans bringing it from Norfolk? The return, they're up 6-0.
ESPN College Football is presented by McDonald's and in part by Wrangler Real Comfortable Jeans.
It's senior day here from Aggie Stadium. Lamar Raynard, a fifth-year senior out of High Point, North Carolina, went to nearby Andrews High School. And when you look at just he and his brethren, 22 seniors in total for this group, two-time MEAC champions, went undefeated last year and capped it off with a Celebration Bowl victory.
And more importantly, as a quarterback, every season since he's been the starter, the Aggies have made it to the postseason. Two Celebration Bowl victories, as well as an appearance in the FCS playoffs. Quite a successful career. I can't think of anybody that's had that type of run in college football in recent memory, particularly within the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference.
Ball will be placed at the 35-yard line. First down.
And before we went to break, you likely saw the point after attempt being no good from Norfolk State. There was actually a penalty on the play, so they had to do a re-kick, and in that re-kick, Josh Nordone was able to convert. So it's 7-0 Norfolk State. That's where we are now, 12:26 to go in the first quarter here from Greensboro. Jermaine Martin with the handoff, and looking like the Aggies will have some success running the ball early on as they get some good yardage on first down from Jermaine Martin that moves the sticks.
Yeah, this is what you call running off tackle. Great job of vision by Martin. You're going to see it bounce it to the outside, gets the leverage on Dale Craig, number 24, the inside linebacker, attacks the hole, picks up great yardage on first down. But look at this.
A personal foul called against North Carolina A&T, so essentially that will nearly negate a 17-yard run from Jermaine Martin.
And these are the distractions I'm talking about that happen on homecoming. You go out there, you try to impress your family, your friends that are all watching this game. You do a little bit too much instead of doing your job, and you don't pay attention to detail. Then all of a sudden, in a game that you're heavily favored, you become caught up in a dogfight.
And you played at Howard, so you know just how much those distractions can come into play. How do you, as a player, zone them out?
And normally after you get hit once or twice, you kind of focus on the opponent on the other side of the line of scrimmage.
Martin once again, huge hole. The Coastal Carolina transfer gashing to the third level, and Nyree Quinterly brings him down, saves that touchdown tackle, 17 yards.
Yeah, they're going to be able to run the football. Great job by Micah Shaw, the right guard, on the pull. You talked about Martin, the transfer. They like him in to go along with Cartwright as that 1-2 punch.
Here's Elijah Bell, and Elijah Bell down the sideline, but a penalty marker is on the field, and you see Lamar Raynard just around the 40-yard line throwing up his hands like, what's up?
Holding, offense, number 15, 10-yard penalty, replay first down.
Ahmed Ba called for the hold.
Now you'll see number 15 right on that side of your screen. He's got him up top high by the jersey, turns him around on JT Wahi. But I would say outside of that penalty, Aggie fans were excited to see Elijah Bell have that burst. He's around 95% now. That's the best we've seen him look all season, and you can tell he's a special talent when healthy.
And Markell Cartwright continuing to churn along just near the first down marker. Now, Jay, as we open the broadcast, we mentioned that they can't be tripped up here at home because the Aggies, two losses, have come here at Aggie Stadium.
Yeah, all in the last plays of the game. Two losses on the season here at home, total of 4 points. That's how far they are from being a top 10 ranked team in all of FCS. And in all those games, they were winning but didn't seal the deal at the end. And now North Carolina A&T finds themselves in second place in the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference.
Came down to a matter of 6 seconds in those losses. Second and one, play, action pass, and Raynard feeling the pressure from the Spartans, and they bottle him up. Deshaun Middleton in on the tackle, 3-year starter at Norfolk State.
And this is where, for North Carolina A&T, the mesh. When do you run the ball? When do you throw the ball? I think they're having success running. They let to pass. Quarterback gets flushed out the pocket. Great job avoiding the sack. But I think A&T's established they have controlled the line of scrimmage. Wear down this Norfolk State defense running the ball behind Cartwright and that offensive line.
Once more, the handoff. And there it is. Tyreek Givers-Wilson was in there first to bring down the ball carrier.
And he's short on there. And this is where some people here in Greensboro have been questioning, you know, Chris Barnett, first-time offensive coordinator for the Aggies. You have a lot of weapons, but third-down efficiency hasn't been there. And they think that he's gotten away from just letting A&T pound the football, show they've got better athletes, sometimes tries to out-scheme the defense, and that's put him in trouble. And right now he's got a crucial fourth down here early at homecoming.
Big call here, fourth and three from the 39-yard line of Norfolk State. A little option pitch out at Cartwright. That was high school teammate to high school teammate. As Nigel Chavis brings him down, but gutsy call, it pays off for the Aggies.
And this is what we're talking about. Schematically, I'll give him credit. Schematically, they win this advantage right here. This is the end man of the line of scrimmage. He's in a no-win situation. Once they run the ball, he goes there, pitch it outside, no outside contain. Excellent use of drawing up a play schematically by Chris Barnett. See, like I give him credit.
Yep. So
I critique him, but when credit's due, I give him credit. Sometimes it gets a little fancy, but that play there, he saw something that he liked by design, and it was effective.
First and 10, Reynard decides to keep it, call his own number, and that's good enough for a first down. We talked about Chris Barnett. He's replacing Chip Hester, who was here for a number of years, who's now the head coach over at Barton College. So Barnett coming over from a D3 program in nearby Guilford College to now take over this powerhouse, not only in the MEAC, but in FCS as well, in North Carolina A&T. The offense continuing to move as we're nearing just about the 8 minute mark, eighth play of the drive coming up here. Cartwright, the ball carrier, and really nowhere to go on that first down play.
And Cartwright deciding to cut against the grain and didn't need to do it in that situation. But you know, you talk about the new offensive coordinator, and I think it's unique. You know, we always say normally in the game of football, whoever has the best horses wins the race 9 out of 10 times. Well, I think A&T's got the best horses. They've had them for a long time in the conference. So I think that mesh mode, window, who can I rely on, who can I count on? As a coach, you normally try to think you're the smartest guy in the room. But I think now they finally learned their lesson. He's got that mesh, and he's going to let these horses run.
All right, so first pass of this drive out to Cartwright coming out of the backfield, brought down by Bobby Price.
Perfect example, right? This play is well defensed by Norfolk State. But when you got the better horse in Cartwright, you just get Cartwright the football. They can be covered all they want to. They can cover him all they want to. They've got to sift out, but he's a better running back than that linebacker. He's going to make a miss, pick up positive yardage. Schematically on paper, it looked like, hey, they're in the right position. They can stop us. But in this case there, when you got the faster horse, let him win the race.
The 6 yard line is the yard to gain for first down.
Better
and
job.
And once more, there's North Carolina A&T finding the end zone. Compliments of Jermaine Martin. How about Briante Matthews clearing the way for Martin?
Matthews did a great job, but I really like the job by number 46, Hollingsworth, the fullback. Follow the fullback and you'll find a good play. Look at number 46, seal it right there. That's the crease. Then able to get to the second level was Matthews, as you mentioned. Perfectly executed run play by North Carolina A&T for the score.
Noel Ruiz on for the extra point attempt. It is good, and we're tied at 7-all. The 8 yard scamper from Jermaine Martin evens the score. We're still with 6:50 to go in the first quarter. Eleven plays, 65 yards, more than 5.5 minutes eaten up on the clock as an 8 yard score from Jermaine Martin evens it at 7 apiece.
Yeah, perfectly executed. Take a look here. This is the key right here. This is JT Wahi. He thinks he's going to be untouched here, but they're going to sneak the guard around to make this block in the hole. Just when he thinks, okay, I can come and make that tackle. Whoa, where'd this 300-pound lineman come from with the running back behind him? Nice execution by the Aggie offensive line.
So Noel Ruiz will kick things off. The dangerous return man and Marcus Taylor is back to receive. Remember, he returned a punt to get the Spartans on the board. This time it's the up man and Stuart Anderson. And the redshirt freshman gives Norfolk State some solid field position. A little scuffle and skirmish just around the 25-yard line, but it's homecoming.
Yeah, but it's always those guys that play special teams that don't get a lot of time. They want to show out, and after the whistle, try and get mix it up a little bit. Good job by the officials of separating it, and I think, fortunately for both ball clubs, I don't think there's going to be any penalties or any ejections off of that.
Sometimes you just got to let them play, Jay. And Norfolk State, of course, no stranger to homecomings. This is their fourth, including their own. They have been unsuccessful in the last three attempts, and they've also faced teams coming off bye weeks as we take a look at Jawan Carter, the sophomore out of Richmond, Virginia.
He has to play well. I mean, quite simply, watching the tape of him, watching the film, see he gets a little lazy with his footwork every now and then, telegraphs his throws, explosive runner, but has to become a better passer in this game.
Feeling a little bit of pressure and just throws it away. But for Norfolk State, what do you think they're feeling given the fact that they've kind of been on this homecoming tour?
Yeah, let's be honest. Your homecoming opponent's for a reason. Savannah State scheduled you for their homecoming because Savannah State thought that was their best chance at a victory. Florida A&M did the same thing early on. So what you have to do is you have to take it personal. And you have to say, we're going to be homecoming killers. If they don't win a game like this, the next year they're going to be in four more homecomings. So in the HBCU landscape, you schedule a homecoming game where you can win. Latrell Scott knows that, and he's committed to not allowing that to continue to happen to his program.
And Scott felt like a win today would obviously add a great boost to his program. He started out 3-1 on the season. Carter just misfires to Taylor.
Yeah, and you got to make that throw. I mean, you're a college quarterback on this level. It's a 5-yard out route with your best offensive weapon in Marcus Taylor in the flat, and you miss him. You throw the ball behind him. That's the difference between an offense that's efficient and an offense that's struggling, averaging just 16 points a game.
That brings up 3rd and 10 from the 31-yard line.
It's 3rd down.
Savage pitted to the left of Carter. With time, and again,
yikes.
Just not able to deliver there to Justin Smith.
Clean pocket. I mean, the pocket was clean. Good job with the protection. The receiver was open, but I always make the argument, if you can't throw a curl route, then you're an inefficient quarterback. And Marcus and Jawan Carter early on, and I talked to Coach Latrell Scott, he said if Carter doesn't get it going early, he will hook him and bring in the freshman, DeAndre Thomas. So missing wide open receivers like that, not going to lead to success for the Spartans.
Deshaun Baker called for the fair catch. And we'll step aside quickly here. 6:25 remaining. It's 7-all.
Switch now and get Fios Gigabit connection with TV and phone with a 2-year agreement. And now get a year of Amazon Prime and an Amazon Echo on us.
And one of the many festivities during homecoming week, the Greek Step Show for the greatest homecoming on earth. The ladies and the gentlemen getting it going.
Them look like the pretty
SG
boys,
Rose,
yeah.
And yeah, the Kappas, Kappa Alpha Psi. You like it. They're so smooth, though, don't you think, Jay?
I mean, they try to be, you know. let's not get it twisted. Everybody, it all starts with the football team first, and then Greek life takes over secondary on the HBCU yard. But see, they're going to Q. I give it up to the bro.
A lot of football players are Qs.
Lamar Raynard is a Q for North Carolina A&T starting quarterback.
Got to throw up that hook as well as Cartwright with nowhere to go. So kick off your week 9 NFL Sunday with ESPN at 10 a.m. Eastern. Same for the guys. We'll have all the early breaking stories, injury updates, and preview each game right up to kickoff. And you can catch it on the ESPN app just like everything else, so you can watch it anywhere. So Cartwright, who had only 48 yards in his last game against Aaron and Al. Is Lamar Raynard one-on-one coverage with JT Wahi and Elijah Bell just overthrew his target. So taking a deep shot early with Bell, like you said, feeling near 100%.
And that's what you have to do. You've got to give him an opportunity. He's a game breaker. They like his chances on those 50-50 balls. He finds a way to come down with it on a continuous basis.
Now third and eight. Reynard swinging to his right. Reynard looking downfield, finally lets it go at the last minute and just threw the hands of Ron Hunt too high.
And another missed opportunity there. Great job of sealing the edge by Markell Cartwright from the running back position. But give credit to this defense from Norfolk State. We knew it would be a challenge. They are the strength of this football team. Right now doing a pretty good job of going toe-to-toe with this Aggie offense.
The Spartans defense, fourth in pass defense in the FCS, 14 overall in total defense. So the Aggies forced to punt. Michael Rivers boots it away. And remember, Marcus Taylor already returned one for a touchdown. This one he just lets bounce down, and it's down just near the 31-yard line. So, Jay, coming in, we knew that the defense was going to be solid for Norfolk State. It has been all season. But compared to their offense, what do they have to do?
Yeah, I think, and this is the most shocking thing. I mean, the defense is doing well. They've got some speed, and Wahi and those guys, and Chavis, they're good. But I'm surprised because Trell Scott is an offensive-minded head coach. He was an OC throughout his career bringing it up. And I think we saw it from the first time the offense came on the field. It all starts with having a trigger man that has a confidence to throw. They've got some skill position guys. But I think offensively where they struggle is the quarterback position along with the offensive line. That's not a good combination.
Of a punt recovered by the defense is under further review.
So the play is currently under review after that fair catch from Taylor.
Yeah, but it might have hit one of the Norfolk State protectors back there. I initially thought it was an A&T defender that it hit. But it was a short punt that was shanked. And they're going to take a look to see exactly who it hit. But I'm fairly confident. I thought I saw it hit the Aggie first.
Let's take a look at it again here.
So it's not going to be around Taylor. That's the call. Get away.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's an A&T defender. Once it hits number 42, that's it right there. So it hit off the leg of 42.
Will Jones.
And then that's where the whistle comes in. So this ball will remain possession of Norfolk State.
Seemingly a pretty cut and dry one for the replay officials. But back to your point very quickly, Jay, just about the Spartans' offense and just how they just have been anemic, quite honestly. Latrell Scott said this week, it's like a pitcher not having run support. And as a baseball player as well, you probably understand that analogy.
Yeah, I mean, and that's the tough part about it, because at a certain point, you're supposed to be a team, but you start looking at your offense like, man, get your job.
At the further review, rolling on the field has been confirmed. The ball was touched by the kicking team at the 38-yard line, and we'll be first out.
You know, and that'll break up a team, be quite honest. I mean, when the offense is rolling and the defense is giving up a lot of points, you question them. Vice versa, when the defense is holding teams to less than 14, 15 points a game, you start telling the offense, get your act together. And that's just human nature.
This Norfolk State offense putting up just over 16 points a game. Carter, right there, first completion of the game. Marquis Ellington with a reception. Redshirt sophomore out of Neptune, New Jersey.
And I think, you know, we talk about the 16 points a game, and that's going down. I mean, their first game of the year versus Division II Virginia State, they put up 34. And versus a winless at the time Delaware State squad, they put up 54 points. Since then, 0-6-3 points. Talking 9 points in three games, this offense is struggling.
Gerald Hewlett in the backfield. He gets the handoff up the middle. Burst of steam and another first down. So back-to-back plays picking up good yardage. That moves to six.
Yeah, good job running just right behind the center. Wes Jones, one of their better blockers there, number 60. You see him seal the inside linebacker, Keandre Richardson from North Carolina A&T. A nice vision by Hewlett.
You shouted out Wes Jones, number 60, the center, experienced starter out of Wilmington, Delaware, big leader up front along that O-line.
Take a look at Marcus Taylor in the slot now. Number 5, he can hurt you, top of your screen.
The pass to Chuma Awana, and Awana still on his feet, continuing to break tackles before he's wrapped up. Julius Reynolds in on the tackle.
That's what we say for Norfolk. When they get you on the perimeter, the skill position guys, they can hurt you. They can do some damage. A nice wide receiver core. You'll see them give you a nice stiff arm there, and that's what you want from a 6 foot 3 inch wide receiver. Play big, run through the would-be tackler, and pick up those extra yards after catch.
Norfolk thus far, 3 plays on this drive, 44 yards and counting. Carter keeps it himself. Carter with some tough contact down near the 8-yard line. Richie Kittles in on the stop.
These are decisions you have to make at the quarterback position, and a good job by Carter calling his own number, picking up positive yardage on first down. Now second and short, the playbook is wide open.
First time we're seeing Cameron Brent in the backfield alongside Carter. Second and 2. And some movement on the outside, trying to get going before the ball was snapped, was Chuma Awana. A little pushing and shoving.
Number
match.
15. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Wow, now. Awana got away with one. He should have got another foul for 15 yards. After he went offside, he gets into it and take a look. They're talking, gives him a shove and a push. That's 2 pushes versus Amir McNeil. Very fortunate he wasn't flagged.
So that backs him up 5 yards. 2nd and 7, they could still make a first down. And right there is Marcus Taylor kind of thrown behind him. He was able to corral it down to the 10.
And that's another one where not an accurately thrown ball, but in fairness to Carter, that wasn't a nice crisp route either. Taylor rounded that route at the top, and that's hard to throw to as a quarterback.
One of the things he's had to overcome in the last couple of weeks is trying to correct those bad throws, and Latrell Scott feels like Carter has been making some good decisions. What do you go with here as a play call?
To try to find a one-on-one matchup and get it to your playmakers. And keep in mind, you only need 6 yards to pick up the first down. So use the end zone as a threat, but I go underneath to pick this up.
Taking late. The time, going to the outside.
Late.
Well, they keyed the right guy in Marcus Taylor, their best playmaker.
Give you a little football one-on-one. Look for a matchup. Pre-snap read. Tell me, how open is he out here in the flat? What's he holding on to the football for? As we roll, he's open. Get it to him. Get it to him. You throw the ball out of bounds. That's where you get the most out of your pre-snap read. You read the defense and the coverage. They didn't take away Taylor. If you put that ball on him early, he can turn and possibly score, but very easily pick up the first down.
You see a man down for the Aggies, Deion Jones, one of the fifth-year seniors for this group. Strong tackler out of Belmont, North Carolina.
Well, yeah, and he's a starting defensive player for them. And at this point in the year, North Carolina A&T, they're battling the injury bug. They lost their All-American cornerback, Matt McCain, who's out for the season. And he's one of the best cornerbacks in all of college football. Now Deion Jones limping. You got to start worrying about the health of the Aggies coming down late in the year.
So Scott sent on his kicking unit, a 32-yard attempt for Josh Nardo. Nardone gets it to go. So Norfolk State on top, 10-7 on the road with 2:18 remaining here at Aggie Stadium.
And what a difference it makes. Remember when it was 2nd and 2 after the great run by Taylor, then they get the offsides call, Then they have the incomplete pass and didn't capitalize on that drive. When you're on the road taking on a homecoming team, you got to finish those drives. You got to capitalize.
And you talked about Mac McCain missing from that secondary, a terrific young talent for North Carolina A&T, a local kid. Injured his ACL, tore his ACL against Bethune-Cookman a couple weeks ago, and they will certainly miss him, I'm sure, down the stretch. Amir McNeil, though, they feel like has done a good job for stepping in.
Yeah, okay, but McCain's a difference maker.
Yeah.
You know, he gets 108-yard touchdown returns against East Carolina. He was a freshman sensation. It was preseason All-American FCS and was not disappointing this year. He's an NFL guy. He's going to be a Sunday player that you see playing on Sundays in the NFL. And I think the test for A&T is going to be how do you recover behind losing a guy like Mac McCain, so talented in your secondary.
That just looked like a bull running through as William Hollingsworth on the return. He just lowered his head and a full steam ahead.
We call that's a homecoming kickoff return. That's a homecoming kickoff return. One of the up men get it. He's not going side to side. He's trying to blow somebody up. Bam! He's trying to blow him up, wins that battle, and keeps on going. Big William Hollingsworth, been watching him blow up folks down here in Greensboro for a number of years, the senior from Plymouth, North Carolina.
Jay, would you consider that the greatest kickoff return blow up?
Collision.
On Earth?
Collision.
You know, the collision, right? Because we're talking about the self-proclaimed greatest homecoming on Earth.
It's hits like that while they're trying to get kickoff returns out of the game of football, because that was a collision. Two people running head on. Mano y mano. Who's more macho? Hollingsworth showed he had some macho, didn't he?
Moxie for sure. On the 37-yard line is where the Aggies will start this drive. The handoff to Cartwright, and Cartwright continuing to gash. You think he is motivated to get those 1,000 yards before the end of the season?
What did Coach Washington tell us yesterday in the meeting? I don't know what he's going to do tomorrow. He may rush for 200-plus yards. He's on a mission for 1,000 yards, and he's running real hard. Good job by Markell Hardy, number 68.
That was a 16-yard pickup. He wants more, and he's got just about six as he's pushed out of bounds by JT Wahi. Markell Cartwright, last year's Celebration Bowl offensive MVP. And he's a guy who will, quite honestly, just run you over.
Run you over, can make you miss, do it all type back. Really good catching the football out of the backfield. Has that shake, has great vision. Pretty complete back in a small package.
And Jermaine Martin, who comes in to spell him, does a nice job on the follow-up, just a redshirt sophomore.
And this is one where they like that little mix that you have. They came in very excited about Martin, the transfer, as you mentioned. And he's got a little bit of a quicker first step than Cartwright. Can be that edge-of-seat type runner as well. And when they get it going, the running backs are rolling for the Aggies. Very, very difficult offense to slow down.
More than 400 yards on the season for Martin. Another first down. This Aggies team quickly marching down the field. Reynard looking on the outside, and Zachary Leslie hauls it in. He loves those 50-50 balls, continuing to wrestle, but holds on. You talk about a tough guy right there.
Oh, that's a battle right there, and that's a homecoming type catch right there. When you got Zachary Leslie, who we mentioned has really stepped up and emerged this year for North Carolina A&T. Watch the catching. He's not going down. He's not going down, protecting the football. That's Brandon Savage all over him. The rest of the defensive secondary comes over. And right there, that was just, hey, you guys can't take me down. Elijah Bell, one-on-one, bottom of your screen.
And Cartwright with the short run. So that brings up the end of the quarter. North Carolina A&T down by three, but they're driving. Come back to Aggie Stadium for GHOE.
USAA Bank helps you stay a step ahead. Find help at every turn.
Yeah!
With USAA Bank.
so far. North Carolina A&T, bout on their rushing offense.
It's homecoming here. You know, I know they like to say the difference between when you pledge and when you rush. Right now we're seeing the rush take place down here in Greensboro. North Carolina A&T controlling the line of scrimmage, using running back by committee, Markell Cartwright and Jermaine Martin. With that offensive line, they're starting to force their will on the Spartan defense.
And you see there, 130 yards already against this Spartans defense, who only gives up a buck 50 a game. Also, A&T winning the time of possession battle. And just coming out of the break.
First time out of the half will be a 30-second timeout.
North Carolina A&T takes the timeout.
And that was more of a schematic thing there. Latrell Scott realizing the importance of trying to hold on to this lead, at least force the Aggies into a tie with a field goal, not giving up a touchdown if possible.
My bad, the Spartans spend a timeout here while our Week 9 Monday Night Football matchup is a crucial one between 3 and 4 teams coming off the bye in the Big D, Titans, Cowboys, and Amari Cooper making his Dallas debut, 8:15 Eastern on ESPN. Also simulcast on ESPN2 in Spanish and available, as always, on the ESPN app. Our coverage begins with Monday Night Countdown at 6 p.m. So now, play will resume here. And Reynard under center. And finding his man, rolling out is Quinzel Lockhart, and he's in for the score!
Easy. It's too easy. Misdirection, play action. All Lockhart has to do is get leverage on number 24, put him in the trail position, make it a foot race into the end zone. Nice play call by North Carolina A&T. And good execution by Raynard and Lockhart.
Lockhart, the 8-yard touchdown, his second of the season, exclamated with the extra point from Ruiz. 14-10, A&T reclaims the lead on homecoming weekend from Greensboro.
We have mixers every Thursday.
Geico.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Mountain Dew. Do the Dew.
Back here at North Carolina A&T, and Jay, we were saying earlier on, we were thinking to ourselves, where are the bands? We hadn't heard them, but now they're starting to rev up a little bit.
They're starting to crank it up, and this will be a good matchup for the bands at halftime. Two top five bands in our rankings, so stadium starting to get here. Good football game down on the field. I'm sure the folks here are happy that the hometown Aggies have their lead in this football game.
Taylor set to bring it out. Taylor still on his feet, going to the right side of the field.
Horse collar.
And he's dragged down by a horse collar. You see the laundry launched onto the field.
Yeah, 15 yards to that return.
Derek Williams will be the guilty party.
Can't bring them down from behind and leave your feet. Seemed like that was a pretty clear horse collar tackle by definition.
Personal foul, horse collar tackle. Kicking team, number 21. 15 yards added to the dead ball spot. Horse foul.
See that? He's got them high and he leaves his feet. They're going to call that all the time. Very tough to tackle anybody above the shoulders. But let's go back to that and take a look at this poor defense by Norfolk State. Look at these two guys right here. Between the two of them, they've got to make a wall on the outside. But look at the confusion with the play-action pass. You're going to see him look in the backfield, take a step up. You're giving up your leverage on the man-to-man. Don't know who you're supposed to guard. That's Givers Wilson and Dale Craig. How does Lockhart get by both of them? If you're confused, just hit somebody. Throw them off the route. Disrupt the route. But instead, we saw Givers Wilson just look in the backfield, get in the way, and as an easy throw and catch.
The pitch out to Gerald Hewlett. And Hewlett, good enough for a first down, brought down by Richie Kittles, redshirt junior out of Fort Lauderdale.
Wow, this is a great job of blocking on the outside perimeter. by Mark Ellington. So often wide receivers are caught holding, but when you've got Ellington 6'5", 200 pounds, watch him on the edge, seal inside out. Right there, he's got him inside out. There's no place that number 9 can go. That's how you just get in the way of the running lane, and good things can happen in the run game.
Once again, the toss to Hewlett, and Hewlett brought down by Turner Echols.
And this is what you have to do against North Carolina A&T. This is a defensive front that is the best in the conference, possibly in all of SEC football. You're not going to beat them running right at them. You got to take them side to side. Try and tire them, make them run, make the big guys inside, McKnight and Cates, try and wear those guys down running side to side. Then you can try and run directly after them.
And we talked about the impact player early on about Daryl Johnson. We haven't called his name much. This is one of the top defenses in the nation. And the quick throw out to Awana. A strong throw there from Carter on the mark.
Man, good job by Awana, though, using that 6 foot 3 inch frame, going up and getting that ball at its highest point to make the catch. And Norfolk State, they're showing some signs of life offensively. It's just you got to be able to finish drives. And normally a team like this, when they're struggling, they get this part of the field and they start to self-inflict themselves with wounds.
Well, 6 yards on that pickup, and Jay already with 10 points. That's more than they've scored in the last 3 games. And one of the areas where they have faltered are turnovers. And thus far, they've done a really good job to this point holding on to the football.
You're absolutely right. Protecting the football is the key, what Coach Scott alluded to during the week. But I'm not letting the offense off the hook yet, because they've got 10 points, but 7 came because of the
right
special team by Marcus Taylor. So they've got to show they can put the ball in the end zone. I'm still saying they're scoreless in touchdowns by the offense the previous 3 games, including their own homecoming.
Fair.
How do you not score a touchdown in your own homecoming?
Second and 6. And Carter automatically eyeing Isaiah Winstead, trying to make a play much like Zachary Leslie. And a penalty flag comes out as he was guarded by Amir McNeil.
I just don't like a flag being thrown in this position at all, one way or the other. I thought this was just football. They should pick this up, unless there's something obvious that we missed.
Pass interference, defense, number 24. 15-yard penalty for the previous spot. Automatic first down.
I mean, that's a back shoulder throw. He turned around to look for the football.
I'm with you on that one, Jay.
Yeah, that's the football. He's turning around looking for the football. He was trying to make the interception, and I actually thought it was Winstead who hooked his arm inside to prevent him from coming up with the possible interception.
6 penalties for 65 yards now against North Carolina A&T. That moves the Spartans down to the 20. Rush out of the pocket and just throws it away as Jawan Carter. Bringing the pressure was Julian McKnight from the backside.
Big Julian McKnight, one of the 22 seniors that Coach Washington said he has to replace, but said some will be tougher to replace than others. And I think just on that defensive line, they're losing 3 out of the 4 defensive linemen, which has been a mainstay here for the Aggies. McKnight's one of them.
The only to return will be Daryl Johnson.
Oh, wow.
And what an amazing one-handed catch by Awana. He faked out everybody, including me. How about a touchdown for the Spartans? 20 yards on the score.
This is how you make your quarterback look good. Inaccurate throw again, but he's used to the inaccurate throw. Watch him just snatch it with one hand. He's squaring up. Ball's in front of him, able to haul that ball in. That's a hard-thrown pass, able to catch it with one hand and give the Spartans the lead here in Greensboro.
Perhaps a SportsCenter top 10 moment, because that catch was so deceptive. You were waiting for the ball to drop. I think the defenders were. Instead, it was Awana who brought it in. So Nardone, good for the extra point, 17-14. Keep giving it to me, says Coach Scott, as the Spartans with a three-point lead on the road.
0-60 in 4.5 seconds. Introducing the Genesis G70.
The Spartans feeling good on the road and hopefully here to play spoiler if you're from Norfolk State, as they're on top 17-14 over the 17th ranked team in the nation in North Carolina A&T. The Spartans offense starting to come alive here, especially in this second quarter. And picked up by the up man and the Aggies. We'll get decent field position. But Jay, I think the Spartans are not only surprising the Aggies, but many of the Aggies fans as well.
Yeah, everybody thought it was going to be another homecoming blowout on behalf of the opposing team for Norfolk State. But they're doing what you have to do. What you have to do is let everybody know this is not going to be an easy homecoming. You shouldn't have scheduled us for homecoming. We're going to come out here. We're going to fight. We're going to play you tough. They brought the band down to give them a little extra incentive. And so far, it's the good job by the boys from the Tidewater area and representing their program, competing with one of the best teams in FCS football.
And I think that graphic said it all. 11 turnovers and 9 points in the last 3 games. Today, 17 points and no turnovers for the Spartans. Here come the Aggies trying to answer on offense. The quick toss out to Zachary Leslie, pushed out by Nigel Chavis. And now, if you're the Aggies, how do you answer here? What's worked so far, Jay?
Running the football, and that's why they come out and throw it on first down. I think they should be running the football. Renard's been efficient, but I think we've seen Martin and Cartwright show they have the ability to be special in this football game.
Well, they racked up 130 total yards on the ground in that first quarter alone. They can continue to add to that as Dale Craig trips up Lamar Renard. Brings up third and one now.
Keep in mind, in obvious run situations, we've seen Norfolk State overload that box and stop North Carolina A&T from picking up first downs in these third and short situations. They're giving them the same look. I think they're going to have to throw the football.
Aggies 1-for-4 on third downs today. And Renard decided to keep it himself, and they stopped him once more. It's going to be close to the sticks, and on the tackle was Dale Craig.
Well, I think he's short. They overloaded that box on him, and once again, A&T comes up short on third and less than 2 yards. They overload the box, and they just put white jerseys everywhere, and a great job by Tyree Givers-Wilson, number 6, this time doing his assignment properly and making the tackle behind the line of scrimmage.
Do you like that play call, Jay?
I hate third and one in the quarterback and shotgun, just to start off. I hate that, especially when you're going to hand off and do lead. But that situation there, I mean, I thought you had to run the ball, but maybe get your quarterback close and go for a quick hitting play.
They're going to try the fake.
Oh, wow, they're about to mess up.
Dangerous play, and they got nowhere as James Mackey was tripped up by his own feet. Negative 6 yards, so the Aggies go in the wrong direction, and that gives the Spartans terrific field position.
And they're hyped up over there. The guys in the white jerseys, that sideline has a lot of energy. They're excited. This here, if this is going to be a fake, he declares it too early. He tucks the ball, so this is the all-out run, and then he slips. Great recognition by Norfolk State defensively. Number 24, Dale Craig, the starting inside linebacker, makes a huge play at Norfolk State with great field position.
And that could come back to bite the Aggies as Norfolk State feeling some momentum. Here's Juwan Carter. Carter feeling the pressure out the pocket.
Oh, that should be a flag.
Keondrick Richardson with that pressure, and then the extracurricular once he's out of bounds. And you can sense the frustration now from this Aggie football team.
Yeah, I mean, they're finding themselves in a good football game. Norfolk State showing some signs of life, and I actually think it's number nine. That's Wilder. Comes over, makes contact, and then a little push.
Defense, number nine. 15-yard penalty. First down.
So you already give Norfolk State their best starting field position of the day, and then you tack on an extra 15 yards after that run. If you're Sam Washington, do you take a moment to gather your guys?
You need to. I mean, you need to tell them, hey, don't get caught up in all this. And these are some of the things that happen with homecoming. I think for A&T, sometimes they don't handle success well when they're playing in front of a big crowd, and they've been waiting for this, and they play to the level of their competition. And you need to regroup and focus on one play at a time.
Cameron Brunt, number 43 on the carry, stopped by Justin Cates. Cates is one of those guys who can make you move east and west, and they've got to come up with more big stops here with a short field for the Spartans.
And that's the beauty of North Carolina A&T. They've got the defensive line to stop. Now, if I'm Norfolk State, I'm trying to find one of those guys in the secondary, throw the football, and you hit them earlier with the pass game. Too difficult to run against A&T in run situations. I think you're going to need Juwan Carter to make a play for you with his arm.
He's got the playmakers on the outside with Taylor Winstead and Chuma Owana all lined up. And Carter being pressured. Carter heaves it up, lets it go.
No.
Dangerous throw in the end zone, and it's picked off by Jalen Bethea. So a bad decision there.
Horrible decision. Don't say bad. Horrible. You just can't do that. You're taking points off the board. Sorry, Tip. Go ahead what you were saying. I just feel for him doing that. That's, as a quarterback, you have to know better. You get flushed out the pocket, throw it away, throw an incompletion. You don't just heave the ball into the end zone.
A flag on the field, but you saw the frustration from Latrell Scott when Juwan Carter walked to the sideline.
I mean, that's just tough. You have to value the football, and we talked about they had the lead because they've been playing turnover free.
The result of the play is a touchback. After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct. North Carolina A&T, number 83. Unsportsmanlike conduct, North Carolina.
Got the numbers confused.
Number 24. It's fouled ball set. The North Carolina A&T ball at the 20-yard line. First down.
Well, let's go back and take a look at this play. Good pressure from Daryl Johnson. He finally made an impact on this game. You see him, number 40, chasing him down, but he just heaves it up, doesn't know how that ball's going to be caught. I don't know if he's thinking it's going to be a 50-50 ball, but when you can't make an accurate throw in the end zone, bad things are going to happen, and that's just a poor decision not to get rid of it. And to see Coach Scott still upset at his quarterback for not protecting the football.
Carter now with nine interceptions on the season. He had a couple of picks last week. And so perhaps the bailout now after that turnover once the Aggies gave the ball to the Spartans after turnover on downs. Here's Reynard from the 20. Quickly out to Elijah Bell. Elijah Bell with a decent pickup.
And I'm seeing a couple things that I'm starting to question a little bit about North Carolina A&T. That last play was a run-pass option, and they were supposed to run the ball, but you can always, as a quarterback, pull it and go to your wide receiver. He pulled it, went to his wide receiver, but there was an entourage in front of Markell Cartwright ready to run the football had he handed the football off.
Quickly, out to his left again. Elijah Bell once more, this time picks up first down yardage. He's a two-time All-MEAC selection. And as you mentioned, Jay, fractured bone in his foot back in June.
I mean, look at this. They've got two linemen pulling, but he's electing to pass the ball. I think you get more of a home run if you give it to your running back the way they've been running the football in this football game.
And we saw a little bit of this back last month against South Carolina State when we were here, where they had an opportunity to continue to run the ball and do a good job. They elected to pass, but maybe they're trying to get Reynard into a rhythm as well as Jermaine Martin. You're not going to bring him down. Still on his feet, shedding tacklers, and then he stood up by JT Wahi.
And this is a great job by offensive coordinator Chris Barnett, realizing Reynard's calling his own number because he's caught up in homecoming. Well, I'm going to put you under center. And when I put you under center, get rid of that run pass option junk. You're going to hand the football off to who I tell you to do it. Give the ball to Martin. He's running good, hard downhill. That allows the offense.
Raynard out to Lockhart. Lockhart, remember, he scored an 8-yard touchdown earlier this half.
On a similar play, but they're running the football effectively. Your offensive line is starting to show that they're too much for Norfolk State. I'd stick to the run a little bit. You can give them the look of the run pass option, but hand the ball off to your running backs who have been the stars of this first half in Martin and Cartwright.
And also eating up some of that clock and time gives Jawan Carter an opportunity to stew on that interception just a little bit more. Leslie slithering through the defense. Leslie. And he's just relentless.
Oh, is it homecoming here or what?
He is absolutely relentless. We talked about he's a special guy. He's been outperforming Bell. And it's because of plays like this. 25 yards.
I mean, he's going to explode with it. He's a big guy, but it's your homecoming. You finish off all your runs. Takes a hit, but keeps the legs going. The rest of the team comes with the push. That was a statement play by this Aggie offense.
Good look there at Chris Barnett, his first season, as we mentioned, as the offensive coordinator. Now first and 10, 5.5 to go here from Greensboro in this first half. Quickly out, Kashawn Baker. And Baker with a nice gain on first down, brought down by Bobby Price.
And they bring in Baker. He's got a lot of that shake and bake for him. 5'6", 163 pounds. Get him the ball in open space and he can make the first guy miss.
One thing that you can say about this A&T offense is the fact that they've been able to spread the ball around pretty fairly over this first half.
Probably a little bit too unfairly, because I would have just force-fed Cartwright and Martin the way they've been running.
Seventh play of the drive on the way. Cartwright out to the left. Cartwright past the sticks and pushed out by Quintrell Chung.
You can tell Cartwright, he's feeling it today. You know, coach told us he knew Cartwright was going to run the football hard today. Nice vision, gets outside, finds a crease, turns upfield, and steps out around the 4-yard line.
Aggies threatening once more in the red zone. Now in Spartans territory, just near the 5-yard line. Raynard in the shotgun. The toss
nice
out
decision
to Cartwright. Cartwright walks into the end zone for the score. Yards on the touchdown run for Markell Cartwright.
Quick decision. Number 9, Chavis, in man line of scrimmage. He looks at the quarterback, pitch it quick to Cartwright. Easy touchdown for Markell Cartwright after he makes the catch of the pitch.
The extra point is good. So stretching that lead 21-7. 4:07 to go here. From GHOE, it's the Aggies rolling. Folks, we're up bright and early this morning in Aggieland for the parade as the alumni and supporters all around were kind enough to support the Aggies and all those who participate in the parade in a special moment.
Talk about Tim. Come on.
How about the Governor Roy Cooper out?
Chancellor Martin, but how about 2017 National HBCU Football Champion? You can homecoming every year, Tiffany, but you can only get something like that, a street display that's going to show your recognition. Nice touch here by the Aggies on homecoming. Governor Roy Cooper, good move being down here.
Oh, we were learning earlier today the fact that North Carolina A&T's homecoming is like the second largest revenue generator for the city of Greensboro. So everyone buys in from the time that you land in the airport. You're seeing North Carolina A&T and all throughout the city. Everyone comes together for support.
Now that's a good nugget, but I got a better nugget for you.
Okay.
You know what number one is? Let you marinate on that.
I got no idea. Yeah.
Furniture Land. Furniture Mart.
Oh, High Point.
High Point and, right down the road where they sell more furniture than any other spot in the country here in North Carolina.
True story, my family drove up from Florida to buy furniture from up this way because we felt like it was one of a kind, only one in the world. That's what they sold us on is Gerald Hewlett on the carry. But back to North Carolina A&T and just the game trends here. You get it going with Marcus Taylor, the first punt return for a touchdown since 14, and then those penalties you're pointing out right there,
yeah.
Jay.
I mean, I think that's the key is the penalties that they've got. 8 penalties, 80 yards. That's keeping them in the game.
And what I love about the game trends, not noted there, as quickly brought down in the backfield is Keandrick Richardson takes down the ball carrier. He's the QB on defense for the Aggies.
Puts him in the right place, mostly the right time. Great recognition by number five. You'll see him rush to the gap right away, make a nice tackle, change directions. Richardson, another one of those seniors that is playing in his last homecoming that Coach Washington's going to have to replace.
A loss of three now brings up third and six for the Spartans offense. And the play clock.
Number 11. 5 yard penalty. Third down.
Play clock was nearing zero as well, so that false start moves the Spartans back a little bit more. Jay, we were talking about that, you know, like the game summary. So you go back to the first quarter. Since like 4:07 then, we've had one tie and four lead changes. And if the Spartans don't do anything on this drive, perhaps the Aggies will have good field position and can put up more points before the end of the half.
They're trying to increase that lead. And so often it's crucial. Momentum going into the locker room at halftime. And it seemed like Norfolk State.
And SUVs 3 years in a row. Third time's a charm.
On the field, we're going to step aside as well. GHOE is lit right now. Great game from Greensboro. Aggies on top.
I have it on all the time. It's fantastic. We get to build toys for kids and change the world. It's a big deal.
The blue and gold marching machine getting ready to go for a halftime. It's going to be a good one here from Greensboro. And we've got the band rankings coming up. And as we saw the Spartan Legion band, they were in the top five. So this is a top five matchup of bands,
Jay. According to the undefeated. Not according to Jay Walker and Tiffany Green.
This is true.
A couple bands missing, but it's going to be a nice show here for halftime. See if the Spartans can get some sparks before they go to the whistle.
This time, it's Carter throwing it out of bounds, but there's a penalty marker on the field. Yeah.
Thrown where you normally see a defensive holding or possibly a pass interference, but downfield in the secondary. This may allow the Spartans to have another first down via the penalty, which has been a pretty good weapon for them so far.
As you stated, Jay, holding against the Aggies. So that keeps this drive alive for Norfolk State.
And now you think if you're Latrell Scott, head coach of Norfolk State, you go over, you talk to your team, and you say, we're going to finish out this half with no more than down by 4 points. And what you want to do is say, we're going to go in either down by four or we're going to take the lead or shrink it. But we're going to control the ball these last 2 minutes.
And they will get the ball start the second half.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Skips a pass.
Well, look at that look. Does that look right? It's not just me. I'm just calling it like I see it. But Latrell Scott is the offensive coordinator. He calls the plays. He's calling a simple hitch route, and your quarterback skips it 3 yards short. And the reason why he called the hitch, easy throw, easy catch, make the catch, keep the clock running, pick up positive yards. Instead, you only use 3 seconds off the clock, and now A&T's thinking with another stop right here on this play, we can get the ball back before the half.
And the run by Aaron Savage.
Smart call. Because of the incomplete pass on first down, he was forced to run it. And a great job by Aaron Savage picking up a lot of yardage on that second down run.
They feel like he's not necessarily your home run hitter, but he is a guy who does all the things right for this group. Redshirt junior out of Baltimore, Maryland, brings up third and four now for his squad.
And surprised A&T did not take a timeout in that situation, thinking with a third down stop, they can get the football back before the half with extra time.
90 seconds to go here. And Carter brought down by Richardson.
So call timeout now.
Richardson on the sack. Is that timeout on the way? Yeah. Clock still running.
Yeah, why aren't you calling timeout? You can get the ball back. I would take my sweet time punting this football away if I'm Norfolk State.
And finally, a timeout is spent by the Aggies. That's their first of the half. So perhaps 20 seconds just ran off the clock there.
At least, and I thought they should have called a timeout before. Let's talk about a little bit what's at stake here, Tiff.
Oh, yeah. Lots. Well, of course, all eyes are on the game in Washington, D.C. as FAMU is checking out Howard.
We got Bowie State, though, cracking the top five. Amir Hall with their quarterback. So Bowie State's at number five. Number four, Southern University. We've seen them. They've been up and down, and we'll continue the rest after this punt.
Jay, you got to give me a heads up on those power rankings, my friend. I want to step on your toes as Baker steps out of bounds just about the 15-yard line.
So we brought in Bowie State Southern. How about Alcorn? We saw that Alcorn, a lot of talk they should be in the top two or three. I'm not quite there yet. Number two, we're watching A&T. We know what they can do. Highest-ranked FCS team in the country. Number one, who's number one, Tiff?
Florida A&M University. FAMU, baby.
Founded when? What year? You probably know all that.
October 3rd, 1887. That's right, on the highest of Seven Hills.
And on the bubble, I got Tennessee State, but Florida A&M struggling right now versus Howard Bison. Alcorn struggling a little bit versus Norfolk State, hanging toe-to-toe with North Carolina A&T. And I'm impressed by that Alcorn team. They are good. With Southern, you never know what you're going to get, but a lot of rivalry. Shout out to Bowie State University and their dynamic quarterback, Amir Hall. I've got them in the top five for the first time ever in doing my power rankings.
Strong throw to the outside to Ron Hunt. He gets out of bounds, pushed out by Brandon Savage. We see a lot of his brother Aaron on the offensive side. So now let's watch what the Aggies can do in under a minute.
This is when you watch for Elijah Bell, but also Zachary Leslie. Those are the guys they like to get in those one-on-one jump ball situations.
And before the snap, a whistle blown. Not sure exactly what the call is.
And they've done a good job filling up this stadium, haven't they?
Yeah.
As the day's gone on, the Norfolk State band left, and now their seats are being taken by A&T fans.
Bernard with time. That was a long throw across the field to Bell. And Savage was there to break it up.
Yeah, fantastic jump on the ball by the freshman. Right here, this section you're looking at, that's Norfolk State's band section. Now, half of that is already being taken by folks just looking for a seat at halftime and more people coming in. That's going to happen at HBCU homecomings now. There's no guarantee they're going to get those seats back.
Yeah, they got to bully their way back into the stands.
It happens. I've seen it.
And there's Cartwright. Cartwright with a churning run up ahead. And that's a first down, so that'll stop the clock temporarily, move the chains after that 16-yard pickup from the senior Cartwright.
Oh, wow, and you call a timeout here, no. A little bit of poor clock management. You just got a first down. Why not spike the football before you call this a timeout? Now you're only going to have one timeout that limits what you can do offensively.
And Jay, obviously, teams practice a two-minute drill every day, so they're used to it. But while Reynard is making the throws, it still feels like something is slightly out of sync here on this drive.
Yeah, they didn't come in with a plan. Like, are you going to attack and try and score and increase your lead, or are you just going to try to play it by ear? Good offenses come out, give me that ball with a minute and 10, oh, I'm going to do some damage. It's going to hurt. This offense here, they kind of got in their own way, wasted some timeouts, and now they're kind of relying upon a big play one-on-one on the outside.
Ball snap. Leslie come back to get that one, and he just dropped it. Almost one-handed that one. JT Wahi on the coverage.
And keep in mind, when A&T beat Morgan State, they were leading at halftime. When they lost to Morgan State. When they lost to Florida A&M, they were winning 21-6 at halftime. So if I'm the Aggies, I have a sense of urgency about putting teams away, scoring as many points as possible.
Reynard going for this one. Leslie once again, that 50-50 ball, but it's out of bounds. No completion. And they wanted that matchup. JT Wahi on what they felt like the Aggies' best receiver was.
Yeah, and this is a good job by Wahi. Turns around, gets in position, but you see the athleticism that Zachary Leslie almost came down with that football for a fantastic play. What a luxury it is to have guys like Bell and Leslie. You can just throw it up for grabs and know they've got more than a 50-50 chance of coming down with the football.
Leslie with terrific ball skills. We've seen that already today. Third and 10 now. And the handoff to Cartwright. And interestingly enough, Jay, they continue to have more success on the ground. If they could just hand it off to Cartwright and Martin. And that will likely be the last play of the first half as the Aggies go into the locker room with a four-point lead. It's been an entertaining one thus far. From GHOE, they call it the self-proclaimed greatest homecoming on earth. And Aggie pride feeling good as they're up. We'll step aside. Come back with us to Greensboro. Well, North Carolina A&T says it's GHOE, the self-proclaimed greatest homecoming on earth. But last week, Howard University celebrated its iconic homecoming on the campus in Washington, D.C. Most Bison fans might want to forget that the team lost their homecoming game to South Carolina State, but the Howard University Showtime Marching Band put on a halftime performance people will soon not forget, including the guest performance from Top Dog Entertainment recording artist J-Rock. Not even the rain could damper the performance as J-Rock and the band rehearsed Friday in the rain to get everything right on Saturday. The hard work paid off in a big way. Here's a behind-the-scenes look at how J-Rock rocked Howard's homecoming.
For me to be a part of Howard Homecoming, you know, this is like one of the biggest things that comes around. And, you know, and this is my first time ever being here. And it just means a lot, you know what I mean, for them to even think of me.
Win, 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 win. Yeah. Curve everything else.
felt the vibe and I felt the passion and everything just when we was out there rehearsing, man. They really serious, you know what I mean? And that gives me motivation and inspiration and a cold drive to, you know what I mean, to go extra harder for them, you know what I mean?
After rehearsal last night, you know, I was tired, but it was still good, you know. I definitely felt like we would be comfortable coming out here and performing for this many people. I was very, you know, confident in, you know, the ability of the band.
What it felt like listening to When the King's Dead, man, it was like, man, I was like, dang, that's crazy how they put it together. You know, I know they probably took their time and they put they all into it, and I really appreciate that. It just came out real dope. I was amazed, I was out there rocking out with them. It was crazy. Anytime I get a call to help my brothers and sisters, man, I'm here. You feel me? Anytime they, man, what's up with Rock? You know, and you know, I'm always love to support, and you know, I'm on tour, and that's my thing. I'm always pushing motivation and inspiration. You know what I mean? That's my number one thing. Even if I'm at my worstest times, I love seeing people do good, and anything I can to help somebody, I love doing that. You know what I mean?
And some would argue that there is no homecoming quite like Howard's homecoming, although as a FAMU grad, I would have something to say about that. When you look at the battle that goes on between the bands, taking a look at our HBCU band rankings from the undefeated, number one, once again, Bethune-Cookman. Coming in at number two, though, North Carolina A&T. Who stands out to you on this list, Jay?
The fact that FAMU's not on there, and I still argue, at least they're getting Southern closer. They're making them a top five band. But I would tell you this. We were down in Birmingham. I really like that Alabama A&M band. That may be the band to watch out for. They do a pretty good job.
All right. So thank you for giving the shout-out to FAMU, the incomparable Marching 100. We'll have more from GHOE on the other side.
Time to pack up, kids.
NFL Sunday Ticket. Get every live game every Sunday at no extra charge when you switch to DirecTV. More for your thing. That's our thing.
Welcome back to Greensboro, North Carolina. The Aggies on top at the half and the blue and gold marching machine. They're sounding really good on the field as we say hello. Jay Walker, Tiffany Green, this is the favorite part of the show, I know, for you, because it is the one and only Gimme Five.
Okay, you're going to like this Gimme Five. Now, who's going to join me, right? I was a Howard legend, so you call me Howard legend. Well, how about this? I'm going to give you the top five North Carolina A&T Aggie legends. The Aggie legends, all right? Nice list to choose from. We're going to start off at number five. I'm going to go Carnell Maynard, two-time Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference Offensive Player of the Year. He can get it done. I know Aggie fans are a little upset. He's coaching Alabama A&M right now, but I got Carnell Maynard number five. Number four, how about this name, Chris McNeil. A lot of people don't talk about him enough around here like they should. I think he's significant because Chris McNeil was the first HBCU player to win the Buck Buchanan Award given to the FCS Defensive Player of the Year. Number three, Maurice Hicks. Now, you had to see him to know how special he was. He could get it done, one of the best to ever tote the rock in the MEAC. And before there was Tariq Cohen, there was Maurice Hicks.
But I know Tariq may have to be on that list,
at number two, absolutely. You know he's going to be somewhere on here. I've never seen nobody with my eyes do it greater than this dude right here. Tariq Cohen, the bigger the spotlight, the bigger the performance. He was special. What he's doing for the Chicago Bears doesn't surprise anybody. And statistically, nobody's ever run the football greater than Tariq Cohen. But he doesn't have a gold jacket. And Elvin Bethea, alumnus of North Carolina A&T, NFL Hall of Famer, great career with the Houston Oilers. I still say you got to go with the Hall of Famer Bethea before you go with Tariq Cohen right now. Not quite making it on the bubble. Dwayne Board, a lot of people don't know about him, won a couple Super Bowls with the San Francisco 49ers, and another QB legend, Alan Hooker. Now, that's my list there. You want to argue about me with Jay's Gimme Five? You can. Hit me up at Jay Walker Sky, but you're not going to beat that list right there.
I don't think so, and I don't think anybody would argue about
they will,
a Pro Football Hall of Famer.
Aggies always
look,
argue.
Aggies getting love, okay? Straight up Aggie pride. Isn't that what they say around here? All right, so take a look at the HBCU news and notes, and obviously this game of great importance with Florida A&M in the driver's seat for the MEAC title. They have an opportunity to clinch today, but they are facing off against a very difficult Howard Bison team.
And we know the one thing the Bison can do with quarterback Caleb Newton, they can score on anybody. Will the defense be enough to hold up?
You are very high on Alcorn State.
Yes.
You have been very impressed with them. They've won the East several times over the last 4 years.
Yeah, they are. And I think outside of the homecoming upset they suffered in five overtime fashion to Alabama State, probably been the most consistent team this year in the HBCU landscape. Southern, we saw them get embarrassed at their homecoming, but since then, Dawson Odoms, he's got the Jaguars rolling. They control their own destiny. They went out and win the Bayou. They're going to be in the celebration, the SWAC championship game facing Alcorn.
That game coming up on December 1st in Birmingham. And finally, the first coach on the chopping block is Jackson State's Tony Hughes.
Not surprised there. Just surprised that it happened during the middle of the season. Jackson State's only one game out of the East. But I heard a year ago he wanted to leave. I think this year they wanted to get rid of him. We'll see what John Henry can do. He's been around the block a few times. See if maybe he can hold on to that job.
We saw 10 new head coaches between the MEAC and SWAC. We're seeing one here this afternoon with Sam Washington. His Aggies with a 21-17 lead over Norfolk State here from homecoming.
Driver Colette Davis. It doesn't have to make sense.
We're halfway home here from Greensboro with the Aggies and Spartans just about set to start the third quarter. But when you look back at that first half, it was the Spartans who really jumped out on the board first, but they had to meet that rushing attack from Markell Cartwright.
A&T's controlled the line of scrimmage this whole game. The offensive line has had huge gaping holes. Markell Cartwright did a fantastic job, joined by the transfer Jermaine Martin, has really had an impact on this game. A fantastic 1-2 punch, but the offensive line has really seized control of the line of scrimmage. Surprised the Aggies haven't utilized the rushing game just a little bit more in this first half. They'll probably make some adjustments in the second half.
And remember, the big play from Marcus Taylor started things off with that punt return.
The most spectacular player for Norfolk State is Marcus Taylor. And then the miscues on special teams by North Carolina A&T gave the Spartans fantastic field position, able to come up with a fantastic one-hand grab to stay competitive in this football game. And have to give credit to Norfolk State. The band came in there and held their own against North Carolina A&T, and the football team's doing a good job. Although those numbers are so one-sided, you look at the scoreboard and they're only down by four.
So they will receive in this second half. The Spartans find the ball in the hands of Marcus Taylor. Remember, he ran one back, and he's got an opportunity to get to the outside and do some more damage. Looks like
a horse collar.
Yep.
And that's something where you have to learn in the college football landscape today. You cannot tackle high. You must stay low, below the shoulder pads. Any tackle above the shoulder pad, they're going to whistle you for it regularly.
And penalties was one of the things that was really the Achilles heel of the first half for A&T. Nine penalties, just under 100 yards. And here they open up the second half with a horse collar penalty. That's 15 yards. So we'll get the call here.
Offsetting penalties, one reading lips, two fouls on the play, one a horse collar, the other a personal foul.
So, of course, Sam Washington, we know he's a great defensive mind, first year head coach with the Aggies, and in the booth with us now is a young man who used to play for North Carolina A&T and Tony McCray, now with the Cincinnati Bengals. Starting in that secondary. Hello and welcome in, Tony. Good to be back here at homecoming.
Thank you for having me. Yes, it's good for you, man, back.
Why was this so important? I used to ask right away, why did you have to come back for GHOE?
It's like a family thing, you know. I get coming back, see football, see some old friends. see some alumni. That was good to me. So it's a good thing to come back.
What's your favorite part? Because as a player, you didn't necessarily get to take in everything. So what did you take advantage of now being out?
Friday I got out and did some things with some friends. You know, usually we're in hotels when I was here because I'm going to play a game on Saturday. So that was the only difference. Other than that, I came for the football game.
So I'm going to put you on the spot right after this play right here coming up.
So Carter with the direct handoff to Taylor, and Taylor trying to run east and west. Can't go north and south there as he's pushed out.
Now, I've been knowing for a while, Tony, now, and I called your game. I remember you played there, right? Mm-hmm. I need you to give it to me real. What's the biggest transition going to be going from Coach Broadway to Coach Washington?
Coach Broadway is going to be more strict than Coach Washington. But okay. Coach Washington is a guy who believes in your talents, and he's going to put you in position to make plays. So he's more of a calm coach. Coach Washington doesn't panic as much.
Okay, I got you there now. Which one did you like better playing for? What style works?
Honestly, for me, I have to go with Coach Broadway because he's going to harp on me all the time. I feel like with Coach Wash, I'm a good player because he put me in positions, but he's going to be more calm. You know, he knows I can do it, but Coach Broadway will make me do it. You know what I'm saying?
And a huge blow delivered there from Julian McKnight as Jawan Carter felt all of that one.
How did playing here at A&T prepare you to make it to the National Football League? You come in there, you're not a drafted guy, but you get your opportunity. What did Broadway and Washington and A&T, how did they help prepare you for what you're dealing with now in life?
Well, Coach Washington like told me my junior year that I had the capabilities to play in the NFL. So after that, he just sorted out where, you know, he put me in tough situations where I can show my cover skills and stuff like that in order to, you know, build a resume for the NFL.
Baker handles it, and that one, ball pop loose, what a hit! Man, oh man, delivering the heat. As that ball was popped out by Nigel Chavis.
I mean, we tell them all the time, and Tony, we appreciate you being here, but we tell these folks all the time, bad things happen when you leave your feet. And we see right here, the hard hit on Baker, ball comes loose. The Aggies fortunate to recover that football.
All right, we'll step aside here as Sam Washington will see his group on offense, and so will you when you come back.
All the way to Exotico, New Jersey. So this holiday season, it's Ancestry DNA per tutti! Order your kit now at Ancestry.com.
You're watching ESPN College Football presented by McDonald's. 12:39 to go early in this third quarter. And the Aggies offense deep in their own territory. Markel Cartwright to the right. The Lamar Raynard, the handoff to Cartwright. Cartwright continuing to find the holes. Great vision all afternoon. And he's brought down by JT Wahi. 22-yard gain for Markel Cartwright.
Just off what you saw there, what should they be doing?
Continuing to run the ball.
He's already got 120 yards right there. You know, nice yards per carry average. He's the senior. It's homecoming. I'm going to make Norfolk State prove to me they can stop Markel Cartwright from running the football.
And that was one of the things Coach Washington told us. He's going to run like a man possessed as Raynard finds Elijah Bell for the first down completion. Brought down by Aaron Chandler. A nice balance. Of course, you want to have it on offense, but what's worked so well thus far is the ground attack.
Hey, that's why you show balance when you kind of have to, but when you can dominate an opponent running the football, there's nothing like that. I mean, that's the best feeling you have as an offensive unit, being able to pound the football and then throw whenever you want to or need to.
And the toss to Amos Williams, and Williams brought down in the backfield. That's negative yardage for Nigel Chavis, a tackle for a loss.
And that's one of those plays where maybe that's a little gimmicky. It's first down, you dominate the line of scrimmage. Why risk a run play where there's a potential to lose 5 yards? Run straight ahead, move the pile. I'm just in the booth. But sometimes I think the Aggies make it harder for themselves, and it has to be on offense. Now they're behind the chains.
Loss of 4 there for A&T. Now second and 14. Play call, it's a little different here. Leonard surveying and hits his man. But that ball may have been bobbled. Isaiah Hicklin, the intended receiver. Aaron Chandler on the tackle. Hard hit there.
Get some pressure and going to make the catch. And as he's going to secure it, nice hit by Aaron Chandler, the cornerback. Fifth-year senior from Norfolk, Virginia. Hometown guy.
The Aggies have been plagued by third down ineffectiveness all season long. They're 1-for-6 here today. Now with third and 14. Reynard, pressure brought. He gets it away. And again, the Spartans defense showing why they're fourth best in pass defense in the FCS.
Well, you get a team in an obvious pass situation, defensive linemen are going peel those ears back and just pursue the quarterback. Great job by Nigel Chavis, that guy who they say is their best defensive player from his linebacker position. Gets pressure, and now the Aggies have to punt. But it just goes back to that first down call. You picked up the first down, run the ball on first down. Don't try a fancy play when I thought they could just move the pile, establish control line of scrimmage, and keep the drive going. Now Norfolk State's going to get the ball back.
Michael Rivers on to punt for A&T. That ball may have been deflected. And now it's down. So a good one brewing here from Greensboro. Upset-minded Norfolk State trying to drive on the Aggies on this possession.
All the way.
That's what Aggie fans say. I don't care what homecoming I'm attending. I want some of that right there. Beef ribs.
Beef short ribs. What's that there?
They say it's a gator. Bacon wrapped gator. That, you don't know about that.
That's, I don't.
You're a DMV dude. Down in Florida, we know about a little gator. Some gator bites down that way as the Spartans.
And one thing about it, you know, a lot's been said. So we're at the GHOE. Mm-hmm. I've been in a while. This is your first GHOE. Mm-hmm. And a couple things I've come away with. One, Aggie pride is real.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a lie. They say what Aggies do. And you go to the Walmart, everywhere. They do take over the town of Greensboro. Mm-hmm. And they paint it blue and gold. Mm-hmm. Your thoughts on Aggie GHOE?
You know, my thoughts are my own, Jay, because I feel like I might take some heat afterward. Just because sometimes when there is such a great buildup, you oftentimes look forward to it living up to its billing. Certainly, it's a terrific homecoming, and you love the tradition, the celebration, the fellowship amongst everyone. But I'm going to be biased here and say...
Don't do it to yourself. Don't do it to yourself,
Tim. That I may have come across a homecoming that could rival or top this. And but I love the fact that everyone takes pride in Aggie land of saying this is the greatest homecoming on earth. And if you're an Aggie fan, you should believe that.
Oh, what a play.
Ease it up. Unbelievable. Chuma Awana has come up with some huge plays. That one to Jawan Carter, but there's a penalty flag on the field. Either way, that was a great catch.
There'll probably be pass interference on the defense, but that won't matter because it was a fantastic individual effort by Chuma Awana coming up with another big play.
Pass interference. Offense, oh. Number 81. 15-yard penalty. Replay first down.
So Anthony Williams, the tight end, called for pass interference.
Pass interference on the tight end. I mean, unless they're calling it a pick play or something, I don't know how you do that because it was a scramble drill. But, you know, people think I'm always for pass interference because I was a quarterback, offensive guy. No, I just like to see the game called right.
So, an amazing catch from Awana is wiped out. And they'll start again. Cameron, Brent. And Brent, just near the 45-yard line, picks up the first down.
I mean, we're going back to that play, still trying to find the pass interference. I believe this is who they called it on. There, I mean. Block downfield, 3 or 4 yards, you don't call that necessarily. I don't know. Get out the way a little bit. Right now, seems like Norfolk State has an opportunity to recover with a nice play on first down after the penalty. Now they're looking at just second and 8.
Picked up 17. Carter, feeling the pressure, escapes the pocket. And Daryl Johnson is in on that play. A very long Daryl Johnson, sitting at 6'5". And Coach Washington just credits him for being a worker bee.
Yeah, and I think he's a little bit banged up coming to this game, so we haven't seen a lot of him as normal. He's a guy in a third down situation. They always keep him in the game. They're going to try and limit his snaps, but because of this being a tight football game, forced into action.
Now on 3rd and 7, the Spartans, and they go to Taylor. Taylor, their best playmaker, and picked up their first third down conversion of the day. And Sam Washington is livid, takes off his headset, not pleased with his defense.
And let me give credit to Juwan Carter, the quarterback. We've been on him all day, right? A lot of pressure in his face. They're going to penetrate. You're going to see the penetration. He's going to stand tall, knows he's going to get hit, and delivers a catchable ball in stride that allows Marcus Taylor to run and pick up the first down. That's good quarterback. That's how you stand tall, deliver the ball, and get some confidence from your teammates.
Remember, A&T number 17 in the FCS, but right now Norfolk State knocking on the door. They've got a drive together. And Juwan Carter calls his own number. And what did we hear from Latrell Scott earlier this week, in the fact that they felt that A&T showed themselves to be mortal this season after going undefeated last year?
They did. They lost against Morgan State, which was a big upset. They just didn't play well. Then the Florida A&M moved the ball on them offensively up and down the field, put themselves in a position to win. And I think we saw it earlier. I mean, A&T's had some chances to kind of put this game away, distance themselves. Instead, they find themselves in a closely fought football game.
2nd and 5, going to the outside, one-on-one coverage for Winstead. Just throwing it out of bounds is Carter.
And that's what, give your wide receiver a chance. 6'3" wide receiver versus a 5'9" cornerback. You don't throw the ball out of bounds.
So an interesting 3rd and 5 play here for the Spartans. They converted already on this drive. And now a timeout taken by Norfolk State.
30-second timeout.
We'll take a quick timeout right along with them. So come back with us to Aggieland as the Spartans trying to keep the drive going. Coming up 3rd and 5 on the other side. Gotcha. See, I wanted to see if you were still awake, Jay. I just wanted to make sure that you were here and engaged in the game, because this is a 30-second timeout. We decided we'd stay here with them.
We should go in there huddle, because I want to know what makes you think you can call a timeout when you're down by 4 on the road. Like, you're not going to need that timeout at some point in this second half.
We've seen an interesting use of clock management here this afternoon. What do you draw up?
Marcus Taylor. They're playing off, which they are right now. They're giving you 5-yard cushion on them. Get it to them. There it is. That's easy. Don't overcomplicate the game. Come out pre-snap look. If they give me my best football player, I'm going to throw the football to them. Make it easy. You know, part of the reason I'm such a stickler on clock management You got to realize I played for a guy named Bill Parcells. And Parcells would spend, seem like eternity, talking about last four minutes of a half and how do you manage the clock in first half and second half. So it's kind of rubbing off on me, and I think there's been some missed opportunities from both ball clubs in this game to realize this could come down to who's got a timeout left. Good recognition.
And while Chuma Awana has made some amazing plays, you talked about Marcus Taylor being the playmaker, it's been Awana who has been the guy.
Yeah, he has been the guy. And look, this is just realizing the defense isn't set. So they're going to break the huddle. They're shuffling around. Look what they're doing right there in the slot. He doesn't know what he's doing. He's confused. He takes a step outside. Oh, okay. I'm going to pull up, give the ball to the slot receiver. That's just communication right there, knowing there's a mistake in the defense. Let's take advantage of it. That's how you play the quarterback position.
So first down now in the red zone, the Spartans. Trying to get closer outside to Isaiah Winstead, spun around and brought down by Amir McNeil.
Nice looking drive by Norfolk State and really looking good. Here's where you know the situation. It's second and two, but you're on the 6-yard line. Pick up the first down first. Give them first and goal inside the three. Don't get fancy. Run the football straight ahead. Avoid the negative play at all costs.
Way to work the clock and this Aggie defense. 10 plays already in this drive. The 11th on the way. And the handoff to Aaron Savage. And Savage is tackled by Antoine Wilder.
See, and this is that time of game, if you've got a package in which your quarterback is under center, use it. This is when you use it. You know, in shotgun, A&T's daring you to throw the football. They came out the last play. You're going to get the exact same look here if you come out in that formation. Man-to-man coverage. One more person, and you can block in the running game. You'll see up top, the receiver goes up top. They're only sending one guy up top. They're keeping the safety close, crowding the line of scrimmage. Got to run something straight ahead, get a forward lean.
And the handoff and runs right into traffic. Keandrick Richardson was right there with him. He snuffed it out immediately.
Wow, the field goal unit was coming out.
But a flag on the field and perhaps some excessive celebration after that hold.
I mean, the Aggies were acting like it was a fourth down goal line stop when it was really just third down.
Rolling on the play, forward progress is stopped at the 7-yard line. After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, defense number 96, penalized half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
Wow.
This is so uncharacteristic of a Sam Washington team who's a defensive guy. Not only did they hold, but behavior afterward.
Yeah, and this is after the stop. You know, it's a good job. Oh, he grabbed the ball and he spiked it.
That was Sam Blue.
Sam Blue.
One of those seniors along that defensive front. So now first down and a lot of opportunity here for the Spartans. Jawan Carter holding on to it.
If they continue to try and run out of shotgun, they're not going to make it in the end zone. Not running the football. I mean, A&T is key for that. I mean, you've got to pick a side, run off tackle, and just try and play smash mouth if you're going to do that from that shotgun.
A&T has had the best defense in the MEAC the last 4 years, top run defense the last seven. So you're playing right into their hands.
I like this look. They put a fullback in the backfield for a little bit.
Spartans, they throw
That's
it
a
up.
And, oh, my goodness gracious.
And Winstead was held up by Amir McNeil. You and I both saw that. The official did not.
Man, you're going uncatchable pass, but, I mean, he had his jersey. There was no way that Winstead was going to be able to jump for the – I mean, he's not holding. He's beat. He's grabbing his arm the whole way. But, yeah, he threw the ball 5 yards out of bounds. Good job by the official. Not a catchable pass.
So an all-important third and goal. As this drive has been more than 8 minutes for the Spartans, you know they'd love to find their way to pay their. They go to the outside of Winstead once more. Overthrowing Winstead again. How does that happen, Jay?
Look at Winstead. He's walking. Look at his body language. He's like, give me a chance. Two consecutive balls thrown out of bounds. Kind of unacceptable a little bit, but I still go back to you get the ball on the 3-yard line, first and goal, push the pile. You could have called two quarterback sneaks and possibly gotten in there.
20-yard field goal attempt from Josh Nardone to bring the Spartans within one.
Uh-oh. Couldn't be another penalty on the Aggies, could it?
Well, they're both pointing at each other at the line of scrimmage.
False start, offense, number 70 and 74. 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
So that backs Norfolk State up 5 yards, so it's now a 25-yard attempt. Nardone has already booted one from 32 yards. And that one is good. So Norfolk State now within one. They had to settle for a field goal. It's 21-20. Come back to Greensboro.
Introducing the Genesis G70.
ESPN College Football is presented by McDonald's.
Welcome back to Aggie Land, North Carolina A&T. Only up by one over the visiting Norfolk State Spartans in this game, of course, has great importance and implications for postseason as the Aggies have a chance to perhaps play in the Celebration Bowl given the score of the Howard FAMU game, or perhaps a chance to go to the FCS playoffs. Malik Wilson on the return, a speedster.
Uh-oh.
And he's still on his feet. He's igniting the crowd. Malik Wilson, nobody gonna catch him. Touchdown, 99 yards.
I think the crowd got hyped and the team got hyped when they heard that Howard was beating Florida A&M. They realize the Celebration Bowl, you mentioned, may still be within reach, and this is a fantastic job by Malik Wilson. And normally for kickoff return, you put your fastest guy back there, and this is when you know Malik Wilson, the fastest guy. Once he gets through the hole here, he's got to re-accelerate, and he's able to re-accelerate with enough speed to go into the end zone untouched after he turned on the jets a second time.
The point after attempt, no good, so a touchdown separates these two.
Look, and as he's going down there, they're like, go, go. And they know you're not going to catch him. You get Malik Wilson in the open, the fifth-year senior from Burlington, North Carolina. Great job of getting the jets going again. That's hard to start and restart. Look at that.
Oh, yeah. He's got the gold link chain. That's his third kickoff return for a touchdown. For Malik Wilson. Wilson getting props on the sideline.
Yeah, that showed up for a cap out the side, too. He's a noob, so the quarterback's a cue, and Wilson's a noob, and a little bit of flavor, everything going on down here for homecoming weekend at the GHOE.
He's throwing up the bunny ears. Wait, did they say go do it?
I'm not one, so I can't.
Yeah, yo, baby, right?
Cameron Brent fields it. Brent moving to the left side. Penalty marker on the field. This one could very well come back in the gate. A good return from Brent.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Receiving team, number 91. 10-yard penalty, first down.
All right, so you saw North Carolina A&T grab a 27-20 lead. Meanwhile, in Washington, D.C., it's 28-17. The Bison on top of the Rattlers, Kalen Newton. He's a special dude. I'm not going to lie. That kid can play.
Three touchdowns on the day, the two interceptions. And you know, we said this before, Howard can score with anybody. They've scored on FBS opponents, move the ball up and down. Defense can be a little spotty in Florida A&M. Looks like Ryan Stanley, who's played great so far. Those numbers are decent, but lacking a couple touchdowns, can he bring his team back in what appears to be a shootout taking place in D.C.?
Injured player in Amir McNeil being
helped off.
Yeah, because he's already stepping in for the injured Mac McCain, who is out for the season, your preseason All-American corner.
And they like McNeil, and they say, we're okay, he's a good player, but now you're talking about having your third string cornerback in, and more importantly, when they spread you out, you're looking at your fifth or sixth best cornerback in nickel situations having to play.
So Derek Williams, next man up, the redshirt sophomore out of Winston-Salem, North Carolina. And Jay, as we go back to that game between Howard and Florida A&M, the implications there.
They're going right after.
Going right after Isaiah Winstead, and Winstead almost able to bring that one in. It's important because the Rattlers have an opportunity today to clinch a share of the MEAC, but also elect themselves as a bid for the Celebration Bowl.
And you know, some of us know FAMU better than others. The one thing Florida A&M does not want to do is have to play Bethune-Cookman, who's down this year, with a lot riding on the line.
Yep.
Bethune-Cookman would love nothing more than to knock Florida A&M out of the Celebration Bowl.
They play on November 17th in the Florida Classic. Sam Washington familiar with that, having coached with the Wildcats. The handoff to Aaron Savage. And Savage followed up by Richie Kittles.
And the last thing I'll say about that is keep in mind, once again, Florida A&M has lost seven straight Florida Classics. So I know they wanted to have it clinched before they got to Orlando. Oh, it's going to wind up interesting if that score holds.
But just look at the parity and the change that we've seen across the MEAC landscape. You have one of the best programs in North Carolina A&T. They're a powerhouse, a stalwart over the years here at 3rd and 11 for the Spartans. And the pressure coming, Juwan Carter still with the football, and he wisely just runs out of bounds. That brings up 4th down, the pressure coming from Turner Echols on the way out. But then you have FAMU and Howard, two teams that, quite honestly, 2 years ago, we weren't even talking about. They weren't even in the conversation with your A&Ts, of your South Carolina States or North Carolina Centrals.
No, exactly right. That shows. I mean, they've come in there and they've got resurgence. I think the new coaches have made an impact. Mike London at Howard, Willie Simmons at Florida A&M. In doing so, I think one of the consequences or casualties of it may be that guy like Buddy Pugh. You know, South Carolina State clearly on that hot seat down there.
And Butler watches this punt continue to roll back and able to field it at just about the 23-yard line. And Jay, that extra point could be very important down the stretch. It's just a 7-point difference between these two. Well, Tuesday on ESPN, we tip off the college basketball season with the 8th annual State Farm Champions Classic with 4 of the top teams in the nation. number 10, Michigan State, and number 1, Kansas in the early game at 7. Then it's 4th-ranked Duke and number 2, Kentucky. Both Sonic blockbusters are also available on the ESPN app, so you can, of course, watch it anywhere. The handoff. And Jermaine Martin picks up a few yards on first down.
I like that call. It was a boring play, but it picked up 4 yards. 2nd and 6, you'll take it all day long, but you allow your offensive line to wear down this defense. Norfolk State's playing like they still have some hope in this game. Run it down the throat. That's the recipe for success in the fourth quarter, I believe, for the Aggies.
Well, an interesting fourth quarter awaits from the greatest homecoming on earth as the Aggies with a 7-point lead going into the final period here.
Your team, your card. Get yours at discover.com/NHL.
It's time for Bringing the Flavor, brought to you by McDonald's. OJ's classic backstabbers is back on the field. The Aggies with the handoff to Markel Cartwright, and Cartwright trucking him. In fact, that's Jermaine Martin, excuse me. Their running styles are somewhat similar. I'm gonna tell you, they're just gonna hit you in the mouth.
And they got the dreads too.
Yeah.
So the dreads coming out the back of it, both of them explosive runner. Martin a little bit bigger frame than Cartwright, but likes to run a little bit more on the edge. Compared to Cartwright, does a lot of his damage in between the tackles. Keep in mind, Martin's just a sophomore, so I think he could be another one of these great Aggie running backs.
Picked up 25 on that last carry. Full steam ahead for another 4 or 5 here. We talk about the Aggies and where they've had great success, more than 330 yards in total offense. About 220 of that has come on the ground.
I mean, it's been there. It's just been a matter when they've gotten away from that on first and second down. Like, they've kind of wanted to show that you can throw the football, and they've got weapons, which we know they have, but I just think you can force feed the run, and they could pick up the first down with 3 consecutive running plays.
Martin has already picked up 113 yards on 8 carries,
nice,
and continuing to add to that number.
This is great vision here. I mean, this play is designed to hit hard up the middle. This is the hole they want to go to, but watch him spin and bring it all the way around and pick up the yards. Designed to go there. Nope, there and there. Get around to the 3rd or 4th option downfield. Pick up the first down. That's great vision to be able to see that's where the hole is by Jermaine Martin. All 3 times in a row. And particularly, the worst thing you hate as an offensive coordinator is an incomplete pass on first down. Mm-hmm. You hate that. You're behind the chains now.
Continuing to learn and grow in this position, they hand it off to Markel Cartwright. This time, Aaron Chandler there, the tackle for a loss. That's just something, as you alluded to earlier, Jay, just superior athletes here with Jermaine Martin and Markel Cartwright compared to maybe what he coached before.
Yeah. And look at that. You've got, what, between them, they've got 25 rush for over 230 yards, 240 yards, and you're not four. I mean, something makes you just scratch your head just a little bit.
3rd and long now. They dump it down, a little screen action for Cartwright, and Cartwright continuing to make defenders miss.
Good effort to get that first down.
Bobby Price brought him down.
I mean, this was a great tackle by Bobby Price in the open field, but Cartwright showing you that he's good out of the backfield and leans forward. It's that extra lean that picked up the first down, just enough yardage for the first down pickup.
And when you look at the recipe for what was really laid out for the Aggies early on, they had 130 yards in that first quarter on the ground. And Cartwright with the carry, continuing to pick up 4 or 5 yards on first down.
This is how you know you're winning the line of scrimmage, right? Norfolk State's in a stop the run look. Look at all these bodies. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 guys on the line of scrimmage. That's to stop the run. They still run the ball, pick up 5 yards. Great job by this offensive line. When you've got 7 guys in the box and you can't stop them, your offensive line is winning the battle in the trenches.
Yeah, just to think they're doing it without the spectacular Brandon Parker, who is now left tackle with the Oakland Raiders. The LA Raiders. And that pass was there. Tavon Higgins. First time his number has been called today. Just couldn't hang on.
And this is a nice throw by Raynard. Threads it in there between the secondary defender and the cornerback. A little wheel route. Got him on the linebacker. Leads him. You practice that. That's a perfectly thrown pass that was dropped.
Brings up another third down. Six yards to gain. They elect to run it. And why not? Jermaine Martin, hard hitting as he collided with Dale Craig and Aaron Chandler.
I don't know plastic to sound so vicious.
That was a hard-fought 8-yard run with a smack at the end. And first and 10 now for the Aggies in the red zone. Three receivers to the top of your screen. Instead goes to the bottom. And Leslie makes the catch. Leslie has really shown himself to be a special receiver.
Did they give him that short side with the one-on-one matchup? Ooh. And that is not a catch.
Not a catch. That one is.
Yeah, they need to get up to the line of scrimmage in a hurry. They should be reviewing this. Yeah.
The ruling on the field is a reception at the 2-yard line. That play is under further review.
What they've done offensively, they moved Leslie from the slot over to the single receiver side that Bell used to have, and it's pretty clear that's not a catch.
Yeah.
And ball moves and everything, but by him doing so, that gives him short side of the field, one-on-one matchups, and that last play call was just get open any way you can down there on the goal line, and they almost got the big play, but this should be pretty easy to review.
For as much as we've talked about North Carolina A&T, the expectation that they would come out, handle things here at homecoming, 17th in the FCS. What are your impressions of Norfolk State? Because they've come out and had a ball game, considering that they had only put up 8 points in their previous 3 homecoming meetings.
Yeah, I was curious about them because I thought all year I've been saying this program is trending in the right direction. And I think Scott's a good coach, good young coach, cares about it. But I was surprised to find out, you know, doing my research on this week, that they're still 7 scholarships short. I think we're starting to see that. Where they don't have these scholarships, they need those 7 scholarships and a couple assistant coaches short. I think if they go with the program and invest in the program, this team could be very competitive. Hampton's no longer the brother across the street from you or across the tunnel. So this is a program that is trending in the right direction. I think they got themselves back together. Now they're still young. They're only losing 6 guys. They're going to be heard from next year, but I think they're really, really close to being able to make a run at a conference championship within the next 1 or 2 years. But as we know so often, it all starts at the top. You got to give them those full scholarship allotment. You can't go out there and think, if I've got 63 scholarships and you've got 55 and 56, you're going to beat me.
After further review, the ruling on the field has changed. The ball hit the ground. It is an incomplete pass. It will be 2nd and 10 from the 14-yard line.
And as you and I both saw that, Jay, it was, you know, a drop there. But you look on the other side with Sam Washington. We haven't really mentioned Ron Broadway's name much in this broadcast. He retired last year, handed the keys over to Sam Washington. But this is a program that everyone's trying to catch in the MEAC.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's only one or two I think can realistically get them in the short term, and that would be a Central who doesn't care about them. Florida A&M, who has a tradition and the power and the athletes around there to do it. So A&T's done a good job investing in the program from the top down. Talk about from their Chancellor Martin to Rob Broadway coming in and passing it off smoothly to Sam Washington. This is still the cream of the crop in terms of the HBCU football experience.
So flanked out to Cartwright, and Cartwright wrapped up, nowhere to go. Bobby Price was able to swing him down. Chung coming over to finish it off.
And did we mention that they probably, in the Mid-East Athletic Conference, they probably have the best facilities.
Yeah.
And they probably have the best campus now. And they take pride in knowing that they're the largest HBCU in America.
Second from 40 yards or more. So now that stretches the lead to 10. Sam Washington likes what he sees. His team is up.
Ball is presented by McDonald's and in part by Mountain Dew. Do the Dew.
Back here in Aggieland, largest lead for either team today as North Carolina A&T stretches it out to 10 against Norfolk State.
We've seen A&T show flaws in their special teams, kickoff and punt team. They need to make a nice play here.
Gerald Hewlett just dropped that one, slowed down the return. The Aggies come in on the coverage. So now if you're Norfolk State, you think back to earlier in this half, you've had success driving the ball against A&T. This time you've got to come away with 7, though.
Yeah, you've got to. Well, I mean,
you still have two possessions.
Yeah, but I get what you're saying. For them, they just have to figure out a way. They had their best drive fell a little short. They kicked the field goal on it. So I think for them, once they get into the red zone, how do they punch it in?
And Carter finding his playmaker, and Marcus Taylor, a guy who continues to climb the charts for the Spartans in career receptions and yards, and Taylor is down now.
Then Taylor gets behind his defender, goes up and catches that ball at its highest point. Let's see, is he able to protect his head on the fall? And I think it was a knee and the back, and oh man, that looks like, that may be on consecutive plays. I don't know if Raynard is coming back because he hit his head on the surface, and it looks like Taylor wasn't able to brace his fall. I don't know if he'll be able to return as well.
And Reynard is currently being looked at in the tent. You go back to how he hit the ground pretty hard after Nigel Chavis wrestled him down.
Yeah, that one there, as a quarterback, that's your worst nightmare. When you're not in control, the defensive lineman is taking you to the turf, pulling you down, and you can't brace the fall.
So we're going to step aside while they take a look at Marcus Taylor here from Greensboro. It's 30-20 with 8:32 remaining in the fourth.
$75 and our best pair you'll ever wear, or it's free guarantee.
Marcus Taylor up under his own power, back on the sideline. You see his numbers from today, 42 yards on 5 catches, and of course that 69-yard punt return for a touchdown that put the Spartans on the board first.
Touchdown.
So first and 10 as the wave gets underway from Aggie Stadium, airing it out. Carter has his man, and Chuma Awana just throws down the defender to Mondre Abram, the casualty there.
And Awana, you just get the notion, he plays like he really doesn't like defensive backs. He just doesn't. That's what you want him to have. This time you give him a chance to come back and make the catch. Ball a little bit underthrown, but watch this. He just doesn't want to go down. Likes to finish off his big plays and throws Abram to Mondre Abram as Abram holds on. And keep that in mind as well. North Carolina A&T dealing with injuries in their secondary. They've got fourth and fifth string defensive backs out there.
Now Marcus Taylor back in the game, and a bad throw from Carter.
Oh, man.
And the interception from Tamondre Abram, and boy, is that a dagger in the heart if you're a Spartans fan.
Yeah, I mean, it was a double move. Put the ball right on him. Winstead did a good job of getting to the soft spot of the defense, but this is a throw where you have to make it firm and put it on him. I mean, he's open to the outside back shoulder, but he throws the ball so far upfield that Abram is the only one that can make the play, and that's worth taking a look. Was that ball moving a little bit? I don't know if they're going to take a look at this one, but I thought it was a good job by Winstead trying to get back in the play. Is this ball moving a little bit? He turns, he doesn't have it. He leaves his feet.
I think Rolls he may have come down with it.
Give it to him.
Inbound. Yeah, two interceptions.
If he's an offensive player, they probably take it.
Yeah. The turnover, gold link chain. Everyone's got to have one on the sideline. I like that, though.
Touchback. Norfolk State is challenged rolling on the field.
Worth the challenge.
Yeah.
And the key is, and here's where it gets delicate. If you leave your feet, meaning you jump or you have to leave your feet, you must maintain possession of the ball all the way through and then have the ability to show the ball to the official. So when you ask me, does he maintain it all the way through?
Another look at it here, because he grabs it and then bobbles
it. But right there, he left his feet.
Right?
So you got a different set of rules. Now, does he maintain possession all the way through? Even when it hits the ground, that ball can't move. I think they're going to take it from him. See, I said, different set of rules. Once you leave your feet, you have to hold on to that ball firmly. You really don't have a lot of wiggle room. That ball is moving a little bit as he goes out of bounds. I believe they're going to take this interception away. Just because the key fact, he left his feet. And you must maintain possession of it all the way through. But, you know, every now and then, what's a catch? If it's a quick whistle, that means I'm wrong again. But
after further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. North Carolina A&T ball, first down.
All right, so the officials saw it another way, Jay. And so,
and I'm going to go back to rule school. I'll admit that if I got to go back to rule school. But I've just seen too many times where if that was a wide receiver, they would call no catch.
Big break there for Sam Washington and his crew. So now two takeaways for his defense. And Khalil Carter now in at quarterback for the Aggies.
I think they're going to start running the football now. You've got your backup quarterback in. Look at that.
So, and it's a good thing because Markell Cartwright has been running all over these dudes today. Between he and Jermaine Martin, more than 250 yards on the ground.
Yeah, they've had the ability to run the football. You've got two running backs with less than 30 carries, over 250 yards.
First game with two 100-yard rushers since 1991. Their opponent then, Florida A&M.
The Rattlers.
So under seven to go. Carter, the senior, with the handoff again to Cartwright. Cartwright loving that left side, just out running, and finally.
Did you see him finish that run?
By Quinterly. Oh, yeah.
I always tell everybody, HBCU football, this is the home of Walter Payton. Not just conference, but Walter Payton went to an HBCU, and nobody finished runs like he did. I'm going to size you up and lower the shoulders on you a little bit.
A 33-yard gain for Cartwright.
And this is what I thought they could have been doing all game, if they just would have force-fed the run.
Now it's Khalil Carter's turn, and we've seen some flip-flopping, if you will. Reynard's their guy, but both he and Khalil Carter have been a two quarterback, and to see the embrace there from Reynard and his coach Sam Washington
this
afternoon
day.
Is done. It's senior day. It's a special
Get
one, but
victory.
You don't want to go down like that. You don't want to finish it off just yet.
They've had that bond, and you just kind of hope it's not a concussion for the young man, because you want to participate in the festivities with your homecoming. His parents are here. We saw them early, and for them to have to worry a little bit, that'd be tough. But A&T seems as if they're going to put this game away right now if they just run the football a little bit. And I think give credit to Khalil Carter, who's a junior on the field, going to graduate, but he's a junior. He'll be the starting quarterback next year. And he came in and won the game versus East Carolina. You know, when they were down, he came in there and threw two touchdowns and gave them that spark that they needed. So they've got a good 1-2 punch at the quarterback position.
He's facing third and eight. Back to pass. Dumps it down to Martin. And Martin with nowhere to go. It's covered up by the Spartans defense. That brings up fourth down. And to your point, Jay, the relationship too between Carter and Reynard, it's a genuine one. These two guys have spelled relief, really, Carter for Reynard, and they get along. And that's not something that you always see, especially amongst quarterbacks, because you want to be the one. And Reynard, you see him still visibly in pain on the sideline.
You know, we don't speculate on injuries and stuff, but you know, being a former quarterback, that's not the sign you want to see right there. Just trying to clear his head a little bit. And as much as we talk about, you know, the path they got to win out, A&T still has a pretty hefty schedule in front of them as well, including final game of the season versus North Carolina Central this year at North Carolina Central.
Gigabit connection with TV and phone with a 2-year agreement. And now get a year of Amazon Prime and an Amazon Echo on us.
Taking a look around the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference, big announcement within Aggie Stadium. Howard University coming away with a huge win at home over FAMU. So that makes things a little bit more interesting now, because both they and A&T, if they hold on, will only have one loss in the conference, Jay.
Ooh, this is wide open. It is wide open. They go for a quick punt, which will be down inside the end zone. But the unique thing is, When you see the standings, Florida A&M, one loss. A&T, one loss. So that's the key right there. Now, we know that FAMU has a tiebreaker because they beat them. So both teams went out as Florida A&M. But how many times during this game have I said that Florida A&M has not beaten Bethune-Cookman in 7 years, and they still have to play.
Why you got to bring up old stuff, Jay?
They still have to play an improved South Carolina State team.
You're right. You're right. They're very different from what we saw.
A&T still has to play. I think they've got Savannah and North Carolina Central. Now, A&T's only beaten Central once out of the last 4 years. So, what's going to happen?
That rivalry weekend, when it comes down to that, it just you just never know as a new quarterback in Cameron Brent with the carry, DeAndre Thomas, we're getting our first look at the true freshman out of Washington, D.C.
Yeah, they like him. You know, Blue High School, went to Fork Union. And he's got those intangibles, 6'4", 210 pounds. But he can be the future at the quarterback position for the Spartans.
They've got some PT the last 2 weeks.
Uh-oh.
And throws it right into the hands Julius Reynolds. And Reynolds, who they like to call the doctor, with the return down near the 10-yard line. Well, he just telegraphed that one right to the Aggies linebacker.
Yeah, he told everybody he was going to the left, and then when the pressure came, you knew he wasn't going to come off of it. And that's what happened. So it's the pressure that gets us. Yeah, I'm going left all the way. And then once the you can't get off that read, Reynolds said, thank you very much. Go see the doctor.
Reynolds now wearing the chain. Of course, the Aggies, a dog. So the dog chain looks good. This young man's quite impressive, though. Graduated in 3 years, teaching classes on campus now, headed to medical school. So the Aggies have a chance to put an exclamation point on this game. And Markel Cartwright, who has been one of the two horsemen on the field, they have been running the ball at will today.
Yeah, Cartwright's a guy that could get it done. We knew he was going to do something special. Fantastic runner, low center of gravity. The change of pace back has been Jermaine Martin. I think this might have been his coming out party for North Carolina A&T. He is the future running back, but the running backs were great. The offensive line was fantastic all day. Those were huge holes they've had in a 300-yard rush performance between two running backs. Impressive.
And Cartwright just one shy of his career high for rushing yards. Carter, dangerous throw there on the comeback was JT Wahi. He wanted to take it away just like the Aggies did.
For Cartwright going into this game, Coach said he wants to get 1,000 yards on the season rushing. He was 365 yards short of that, or picked up a nice chunk today. But the question becomes, why not give him all those carries? He would have had 300 yards for you.
Third and seven. Here's Cartwright. Eclipses his nice career move. High. Moving on the outside, continuing the
that's
bounce.
That's a highlight run there. That's how you cap off GHOE. That might have been one of the best touchdown runs I've seen from this young man throughout his career. A little Tariq Cohen-esque. Watch the bounce in the vision outside. Bounce. Bounce. Get to the outside, they got to make you miss. Keep it going on the inside, stays in bounds. Know where he is on the football field. Great runners know how to finish off a drive. And Cartwright's been a great runner here for the Aggies.
He's collected a career high now. 184 yards. Rushing here today. What a performance he's put on.
Against a pretty good defense from Norfolk State.
And this is what fans expected to see today from their North Carolina A&T Aggies. You see the numbers of Cartwright, 312 rushing yards as a team for A&T. Both Cartwright and Jermaine Martin, as we mentioned, have gotten it done today. Sam Washington's got to feel good, because you think A&T came on like a bully on the block. I mean, that's what they've been around the MEAC, with the exception of tripping up against
Central,
North Carolina Central. But they go on, they win their second Celebration Bowl, the National Black College Football Championship. They go undefeated last season. The question was, how would they respond this year? Could they follow it up? And as you and I mentioned, as the Aggies will move to now 7-2 on the season, not a bad way to follow up.
I mean, keep in mind, at one point in the season, they were the sixth-ranked team in the country. They moved up that high in the rankings after an impressive victory versus Jacksonville State in Alabama, and then beating FBS foe East Carolina. They moved up the rankings, and then the stunner. They went through that spell for about two games and a half where they were playing poor football versus Morgan. Then we came down here and saw them versus South Carolina State, where they looked like they were going to take their second consecutive loss, and then the Florida A&M game. But maybe now they're back to playing Aggie football. And the thing I say about North Carolina A&T, they've proven they can play with anybody, the good and the bad. And that's, you want to prove you can beat everybody, not play with everybody.
And just to think, Norfolk State led 17-14 in the second quarter. And since then, they've been outscored 23-3. And the defensive pressure continuing to come, wrapped up in the pocket for the sack by Turner Echols. Well, Tuesday at a special time of 9 p.m. Eastern right here on ESPN, we'll have an exclusive reveal of the college football playoff top 25 rankings live from Bankers Life Fieldhouse in between games at the Champions Classic. You can always watch it live on the ESPN app from anywhere. Once more being scurried out of the pocket is Thomas. Thomas this time able to pick up positive yardage.
It's a tough task for Thomas. True freshman going against an experienced defense, particularly on the defensive line front. Got a running for his life back there, but Coach Scott electing to get the young freshman some snaps here in this hostile environment. Realizing he's probably going to be the quarterback for the Spartans one day.
Moving forward for Norfolk State, they've got Howard and Morgan State on the schedule. What's to come from this group?
They play Howard very well. Always been a tough fight for those two teams, and Morgan State winnable games. So I think for them, they've got to finish strong. So they're going to drop to 3-5, but hey, if they can win those last two games and win five games on the year, then that's the type of finish you want to have. But this is what it's all about. FAMU's job is a little bit tougher than A&T's is. I will say that. I mean, South Carolina State's playing better. Bethune's arrival. Savannah's playing better, but I think A&T should handle that business, and Central would love nothing more than to beat these Aggies.
They have a history of doing so, but things starting to rebuild down in Durham. Meanwhile, embraces from the coaching staff as Sam Washington and the North Carolina A&T Aggies will hold on for a homecoming win. And I gotta tell you something, Jay, this whole broadcast we've gone through, full disclosure. So Sam Washington is my uncle by marriage. My husband is his nephew.
That's why you were like...
Not, see, but what I will say is, I'll be seeing him in a few weeks for Thanksgiving. There's a good chance that he'll rub this win in my face being a rattler. Because at that point, it will be decided whether they're going to the Air Force Reserve Celebration Bowl or the FCS playoffs. So, Jay, Norfolk State came on the wrong. They put up a good fight, and they hung tough. They led a couple times in this game, but eventually North Carolina A&T prevails. Your takeaways?
I still think Norfolk State's trending in the right direction. North Carolina A&T will play with anybody, but they have to learn to put everybody away. They have the talent to do it. Can they put it all together?
Oh, this is a fun one. The self-proclaimed greatest homecoming on earth, and the Aggies able to walk away with a 37-20 win. It's been a highlight of the day and the weekend. Now they're going to party it up in Aggieland. Up next on ESPNU is the season Ole Miss football. For our entire crew, Jay Walker, I'm Tiffany Green, saying good afternoon from Greensboro.